competitors as we present live the Holly Farms 400 in the brushy mountains of North Wilkesboro, North Carolina. Racing 82 is brought to you by Chevy Trucks and your local Chevrolet dealer, who invite you to see the new Chevy S10s for 1983. By Anheuser-Busch St. Louis, Brewers of Michelob, put a little weekend in your week. And by Timex, timekeeper to ESPN. Timex, we make technology beautiful. It's a partly sunny yet hazy day in the brushy mountains of North Carolina as we're set to bring you live the Holly Farms 400, North Wilkesboro, North Carolina. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Bob Jenkins along with Larry Neuber. When you think of NASCAR competition, you sometimes think of drafting speeds of 200 miles an hour. That's not the type of racing we have for you today. Instead, it's the bump and run tactics. And this racetrack itself presents a story. The turns are banked at 15 degrees, the straightaways at 5 degrees. When you go down the backstretch, you're actually going up an incline of 11 feet. When you're coming down the front straightaway, you're going downhill.
And it poses a very unique problem, not only for the drivers, obviously, but for the crews. You have to drive turns 3 and 4, the uphill turns, differently than what you drive turns 1 and 2. And if the car is working perfectly in one of those sets of corners, probably not working at all at the other end. So the crews have to set the cars up with a compromise, and it's very tricky.
And when you think of Grand National competition, you think of names such as Earnhardt, Petty, and Baker. They're starting in this race 15th, 16th, and 18th, respectively.
Yeah, but they don't figure to stay there very long, I'll tell you. Those are three of them, the most hardest chargers in all of racing, particularly Dale Earnhardt. Earnhardt is number 3 right now in terms of the number of laps led in the 1982 season, despite the fact that he has only one victory. Earnhardt with the one victory is the only one among that trio who has won in this year. Richard Petty, who has not won in quite some time, will be starting from the middle of the pack and hoping to end a victory drought that has lasted for more than a year. And then we get to Buddy Baker. Buddy, the driver who changed teams in mid-season this year. He'll be driving the white red trim number 28. That car, of course, is maintained by Waddell Wilson, Mr. Speed in Grand National Racing. They put Buddy in this car in the middle of the season because they thought they had a better chance at victory, but Buddy has not had an opportunity to win one yet this year. His best finish, a second. Bob and I will be up top covering all the action from high above the North Wilkesboro Speedway, but down on pit road, two-time former national champion, Ned Jarrett.
Thank you, Bob. Good afternoon, everyone. One thing we'll be keeping our eyes on here this afternoon is tires. Not that they wear the tires that much, but you can see Kyle Petty's tires that they have out here, 4 complete sets, and they have more in the background. Tires, after they heat up on this racetrack, don't adhere to the track nearly as well. You'll see cars come in during the afternoon, put on new tires, go back out and run a second or a second and a half faster around this racetrack than they were with the hot tires. So it's not gas that they'll be concerned with. They'll be coming in more often for tires.
All right, and the grand marshal for this race, Joe Littlejohn, a former competitor on the NASCAR circuit, has given the command to start engines, and 30 cars begin to roll away from the front straightaway here at North Wilkesboro, North Carolina. And now we present the starting lineup for today's 400-lap Holly Farms race here at North Wilkesboro. On the pole, Darrell Waltrip from Franklin, Tennessee, in the Mountain Dew Buick. He qualified at 113.860. Alongside Terry Labonte from Archdale, North Carolina, driving the Stratagraph Texas Jean Chevrolet. In the second row, car number 88, Bobby Allison from Hueytown, Alabama, in the Gatorade Chevrolet. Alongside number 3, Ricky Rudd from Chesapeake, Virginia, in the Piedmont Airlines Pontiac. In the third row, car number 33, Harry Dent from Taylorsville, North Carolina, in the 7-Eleven Skull Bandit, and number 50, Jeff Modine from Pleasant Garden, North Carolina, in the Spectrum Furniture Pontiac. Starting seventh in today's race, car number 47, Ron Bouchard from Pittsburgh, Massachusetts, in the Stacy Buick, and Tim Richmond from Ashland, Ohio, car number 2, in the Stacy Pack Buick. Starting ninth, Morgan Shepherd in car number 98 from Conover, North Carolina, in the Levi Garrett Buick, and Lake Speed, car number 17, Lake from Jackson, Mississippi, in the Yazoo Mowers Pontiac. The rest of the starting lineup, car number 90, Jody Ridley from Chatsworth, Georgia, in the safety Ford, and Mark Martin, car 02, in the Rogers Buick. Kyle Petty starts 13th in car number 42, the STP Uno Pontiac. Dave Marcus alongside in 71 in the Hudson Chevrolet. In the 15th row, Dale Earnhardt and Richard Petty. Then we have Joe Ruttman and Buddy Baker in the 9th row. 10th row consists of Buddy Arrington, car 67, Dean Combs in 77. In the 11th row, car number 52, Jimmy Means and 40, Joel Stowe. In the 12th row, Ronnie Thomas in 25, James Hilton in 48. 13th row, D.K. Ulrich in 6, Tommy Gale in 64. 14th row, Jimmy Walker and Cecil Gordon. And in the 15th row, J.D. McDuffie and Jeff McDuffie as the green flag comes out and the Holly Farms 400 is underway. Down the back straightaway, it is Darrell Waltrip leading over Terry Labonte. They head into turn number 4 on the first lap. Here comes Waltrip off of the fourth turn, completing lap number 1. Waltrip leads Labonte in second, Bobby Allison third, Harry Gant fourth, Ricky Rudd running fifth.
It's a tight racetrack as Grand National racetracks go, but because, and we have a spin in turn number 2, Ronnie Bouchard in car number 47, running right in the middle of the field with quite a number of the other top competitors. Bouchard pulls away. We may not even go yellow.
Well, the starters down below us look it over, and they say, no, there is no need for a yellow, so we continue racing. But Ron Bouchard is now about a half a lap behind the last place car, Jeff McDuffie, and he'll be trying to catch up with the field. It is still Darrell Waltrip leading in the Mountain Dew Buick, car number 11. Terry Labonte has tucked him right behind him as we have completed now 3 laps of the 400-lap race that will make up this Holly Farms 400.
Bob, we started to comment that it's a tight racetrack because it's basically a 580-mile track. Certainly not like the super speedways of Talladega and Darlington, but because of the way this track is built, you can run 2 and even 3 abreast. We saw some of the cars near the back of the pack running 3 abreast, particularly through turns 3 and 4. That's the corner that you can just holler into because you're going uphill, and even though the track is only banked by about 15 degrees, because you've been going uphill, you get the effect of about a 25 to 30 degree banking in turns 3 and 4.
Here's the driver that started in 15th position, Dale Earnhardt, the national champion for 1980. Right ahead of him is Richard Petty. I should say Kyle Petty in car number 42. Dale Earnhardt trying to move up from a rather poor starting position. He qualified here this weekend at 111.524 miles an hour, about 2 miles an hour off of the top speed. Dale Earnhardt, car number 15, the Wrangler Jeans Ford.
If there were any qualifying surprises per se here this weekend, it probably had to be Lake Speed, who turned in the 10th fastest time as we look at some of that bumping you were referring to, Bob, at the top of the show going on between Kyle, Mark Martin, and Dale Earnhardt.
Now, it looks like Dale is trying to nudge Kyle Petty out of the way. You can see him making contact with the rear of Kyle's car almost all the way around the track. Meanwhile, to the outside of Dale Earnhardt is the number 02 of Mark Martin. They go into turns 1 and 2, and still Dale Earnhardt in car 15 is trying to look for an opening that would allow him to get by Kyle Petty. There is a look at Dale Earnhardt, driver of car number 15. Here he is coming off of turn number 4, and Dale Earnhardt still tucked behind Kyle Petty.
And if you can stay tucked right down in the bottom, remember, Waltrip continues to lead this race. He does not have a big lead, but he's still out front. By the way, just getting into slower traffic. But if you can stay tucked right down in the bottom through turns 3 and 4, the guy behind you has to go to the high side. And Earnhardt is trying to intimidate Kyle Petty outside of that low lane.
And so with just 9 laps completed, we are already seeing the leader, Darrell Waltrip, lap some of the slower cars. He's already put a lap on Jimmy Walker and has passed Tommy Gale in car number 64. So Darrell Waltrip setting the early pace here.
Yellow flag. We have a car very slow on the high side of turn number 2. It's J.D. McDuffie, one of the 2 father-son teams that is competing here this weekend, the McDuffies. This is the father, J.D. McDuffie, a longtime NASCAR veteran driver in the Max Stores Pontiac.
So our first caution period of the afternoon comes out. Of course, the NASCAR competitors race to the caution flag, and Darrell Waltrip will still be shown as leader as the cars run at reduced speed and the pace car comes out. Back with more of the Holly Farms 400 in a moment.
USA One.
David, I don't know how you guys work in all this smoke and dust.
If you think it's bad here, you're bad on the track.
Man, my eyes are really burning.
There's only one way I know to stop that. 20/20 eye drops. You get the irritation out of your eyes quick as a wink.
Folks, it's 20/20 eye drops for the man who's got to keep his eye on the road. So, for fast relief, get Soothing 20/20, the only eye drops with a money-back guarantee.
Well, ESPN will present the U.S. Bantamweight Championship PKA Full Karate Contest on Friday, October 15th at 9:30 p.m. Eastern Time, 6:30 Pacific Time, from O'Connell Center in Gainesville, Florida. Van Camford and Larry Black will report all the action. Join us Friday, October 15th for PKA Full Contact Karate. Well, there goes Jody Ridley out of the pit area. We understand that some body was rubbing on the tire of that car that necessitated this pit stop. We are under caution because of the spin involving J.D. McDuffie in car number 70. Let's go to the pit area for more information, and Ned Jarrett.
Casualty of this McDuffie, 70, what went wrong?
I guess it dropped a valve, it missed for a couple of laps, and then it filled up with water.
Boy, when something like that happens, there's just not a great deal you can do about it.
That's for sure, just something that happens.
Well, I guess you're going to go out here and watch your son. This is one of the few races that he has participated in.
Yeah, I hope he can finish this one, get some experience.
Well, let's hope that he has better luck than you. And, Bob, you mentioned Ron Bouchard spinning out early there. This tag will definitely be a break for him. Now he gets to catch up to the field.
That's right, Ned, and Ron Bouchard was one of those who made a pit stop during this caution period. Also, Ronnie Thomas was in addition to Jody Ridley.
Well, we noticed that Ron Bouchard was still running very loose on the racetrack even after the spin, so it really was a blessing, not even in any type of disguise, for Ron Bouchard. Talking about Jeff McDuffie, J.D.'s son, this is his third, to be precise, Grand National race of his career. Both of the other times he's been behind the wheel of a Grand National car in a race, was here at the North Wilkesboro Speedway.
And the leader continues to be Darrell Waltrip in the number 11 Mountain Dew Buick. Running second is Terry Labonte. Third is Bobby Allison. Running fourth is Harry Gant in car number 33. We have 16 laps completed. And in fifth place, Ricky Rudd in car number 3. Jeff Bodine in number 50. Tim Richmond in car number 2. Morgan Shepherd in 98. And Lake Speed in 17.
Now, Ricky Rudd in the fifth place in the point standings at this point as we zero in on Terry Labonte. There's a guy that a lot of folks thought might have a win by this point in the season, but it just hasn't fallen his way. They were super hot the first half of the season. They had an incredible streak of top five finishes that propelled him not only to the points lead most of the first half of the season, but he won the first leg of the Winston Cup Series. He's third in points for the entire season behind Bobby Allison and Darrell Waltrip.
And it is a very challenging racetrack here at North Wilkesboro, North Carolina. And we asked Terry Labonte about driving here at North Wilkesboro.
It's really a fairly easy track to drive. It's one of the nicest tracks, short tracks we run on. The surface is real smooth. It seems like you got a kind of a car where it really works good. You know, I've been here before, and the car not work good, and you can lose an awful lot of time. And last time I was here, the car really handled well, and you get through the turns good, and it run good down the straightaway. And we ran real close to Darrell all day, but I don't know. The guy that wins is probably gonna have to beat him.
Well, the challenge is setting up the car for a racetrack like this. As we now have completed 19 laps, we go back to green and a resumption of racing. Darrell Waltrip is in first place. Bobby Allison has now moved into second place in the number 88 Gatorade Chevrolet. Bobby Allison has been lined back in third position until that green came out and he was able to pass Terry Labonte. So Labonte now back in fourth. Harry Gant in fifth position. Sixth is Ricky Rudd. Seventh, Jeff Bodine. In eighth position is Tim Richmond. Ninth is Morgan Shepherd. And then Dale Earnhardt.
And behind them, Lake Speed, then Richard Petty, Mark Martin, Joe Rutland, who was expected to charge from his midfield starting position. We haven't seen that yet. Dave Marcus runs competitively. And then comes Kyle Petty. Still on the lead lap is Buddy Baker, although a little bit off the pace being set by the cars up front running the first 15 positions. Baker, ironically enough, is on the racetrack right now with Jimmy Means and Buddy Yarrington as they race in a triplet down the backstretch.
Another car into the pit area, Dean Combs, a competitor in the International Sedan Series, driving in the NASCAR Winston Cup competition here this afternoon. You'll be seeing Darrell Waltrip go around him, I believe, here on the backstretch.
going into turn number three. Combs driving the number 77 car. So you can see the interval between Waltrip and Bobby Allison now is just about two car lengths. Then we have about a 10 or 12 car length separation between Allison and Terry Labonte.
Well, how Combs got so far behind, he had to make a pit stop during the green flag segment we're in right now. So we go back to sixth position, Jeff Bodine. Going to war with Ricky Rudd, there's the seventh-place car, Tim Richmond, one of the few drivers who's had the privilege of racing a victory lane in the 1982 season. Matter of fact, Richmond is the last driver outside of the big three of Allison, Waltrip, and Cale Yarborough to have won on this trail. He won at Riverside back in July, and he is the last one to win. The series has been absolutely dominated by those other three drivers since that time.
There is just a little bit of haze in the brushy mountains of North Carolina this afternoon, so perhaps the picture is a little foggy. We had hoped that this fog and haze would burn off, but it isn't seeming to do that. The sun peeks through occasionally. There's no chance of rain, but just a little bit of haze and fog in these mountains. Jeff Bodine, car number 50, being followed by Ricky Rudd in the number 3, and Tim Richmond in car number 2 as they come down the main straightaway. Straightaway actually going downhill by about 11 feet. As we indicated, as you go down the backstretch where Jeff Bodine is right now, the car actually goes uphill. There's Jeff Bodine, car number 50. Jeff hails from Pleasant Garden, North Carolina. He is 33 years of age.
One of the most successful short track drivers of our time as far as automobile racing goes, Jeff Bodine, running right behind another pretty darn successful short tracker himself, Harry Gantz, the guy who used to pound nails for a living, as Harry describes it. Now he gets to drive race cars. Bodine has a lot of experience also on dirt. He's probably one of the most skilled dirt track drivers running in Grand National Stock Car Racing today. We first saw Bodine on an ESPN broadcast at Syracuse in the annual one-mile race there, or rather the annual race on the one-mile dirt track at Syracuse, New York, when he came out with that very sleek, aerodynamic, re-engineered overnight race car. Bodine, a very experienced driver, and a lot of people think that he may not be that many months away from his first win in Grand National competition, twice this year on the pole.
All right, Darrell Waltrip continues to be the leader with Bobby Allison running second, and Terry Labonte third. Fourth place belongs to Harry Gant. Jeff Bodine is in fifth place, and then Ricky Rudd in sixth. Down the main straightaway, completing lap number 29 for Darrell Waltrip, who has won the last two races here on this racetrack. He won the Holly Farms 400 last year at this time, and he also won the Northwestern Bank 400 that we telecast live for you on ESPN back in April. Well, as Waltrip continues to negotiate this 5/8-mile racetrack here at North Wilkesboro, North Carolina, ESPN presents a track fact.
You will notice there's quite a bit of difference in the distance between the dash compartment and the steering wheel on one of these NASCAR Winston Cup cars than you would have on a passenger car. There are two reasons for that. One, it gives the driver more leverage to turn the steering wheel because these cars are harder to steer than a car with power steering. And then two, it lets the driver sit farther to the rear, putting more weight on that left rear wheel, which is very important on a track like North Wilkesboro.
This is very beautiful country here in North Carolina and a beautiful racetrack. Darrell Waltrip leads, Allison second, Dan third, Terry Labonte is fourth. We've completed 28 laps in the Holly Farms 400.
I'm Ted Steffen, president of Cleveland Cavaliers.
Darrell Waltrip has led all the way in this race so far with 38 laps completed. While we were away, we had a position change for third. Jeff Bodine in car number 50 was running behind Harry Gant, but at the end of the backstretch, Bodine decided that he wanted to run in third position, so Jeff moves into third, and Harry Gant now back in fourth position. In fifth place continues to be Terry Labonte. Sixth is Ricky Rudd. Seventh place belongs to Dale Earnhardt. Tim Richmond runs in eighth. Morgan Shepherd in ninth. Tenth place is Joe Ruttman. 11th place, Kyle Petty. 12th is Lake Speed. And 13th place now held by Richard Petty.
Well, in addition to Bodine, the other guy whom we've been watching is beginning to make a move, and all you people up north will be happy to hear this. Ronnie Bouchard has improved his position quite a lot. Talking about northern drivers, there's a couple more northern Yankees from Ohio and Michigan, respectively. And there goes Ruttman to the inside of Richmond through turns 3 and 4 as they come out of the fourth turn looking for the home stretch. Joe Ruttman, who is one of the few definite in terms of plans for next year. He is definite in that he's leaving this team. Not definite where he's going, but there's a lot of rumor and innuendo going around right now about a lot of folks. But Drummond is one of the few who has come out and said, yes, I am chopping around. Tim Richmond now drops back to 10th position. Richmond, of course, the man who came out of super modified Indianapolis sprint car racing to come to the South a couple of seasons ago.
There are lots of rumors, as Larry indicated. We'll be talking about them and have more definite words on who's going where for next year as the season progresses. We will have a couple of more live NASCAR races for you this year, one in Rockingham, North Carolina, and another in Atlanta, Georgia, before it all ends up at Riverside, California in November. Joe Ruttman, car number 75, is running in eighth position now. Joe Ruttman hails from Upland, California, is driving the Pet Dairy Buick. Joe Ruttman, his best finish in 1982 was a third in the Daytona 500. He wasn't driving this car when that occurred. He's been driving for this racing team for about half of the season. The number 96 car of Jimmy Walker, the Ford, is into the pit area for his stop. Jimmy Walker is 41 years of age and has not competed too much on the Grand National Winston Cup circuit.
No, but Walker is one of those guys who've been trying to pick up and get involved on a regular basis in Grand National racing. He's from the northern center part of Pennsylvania in the area of Altoona, where there used to be a Ford track quite a number of years ago, and also not all that far from State College, Pennsylvania, where they have a pretty fair country college football team this year. That's the home of Penn State.
Here come the first two cars off of turn number four. Darrell Waltrip in the number 11, right behind him, Bobby Allison. The interval is about two car lengths. Notice the definite two grooves on this racetrack. The lower groove, which is being taken by the number 52 of Jimmy Means, and the higher groove used by Bobby Allison. Darrell Waltrip sets the car into turn number three once again. Brings it off before onto the main straightaway and completes 47 laps. 47 laps have been completed.
Well, certainly the story of the 1982 Grand National Stock Car season has been those two green race cars. If you follow stock car racing at all, you know that here are the people who have won a combined 16 of the 24 events run so far this season. Waltrip, of course, the leader in number of wins with 9. Bobby Allison close behind with 7. But Allison, on the strength of just a tad more consistency among top finishers, leads the point standing. The big fear here at North Wilkesboro today was that Darrell Waltrip, who looked very, very strong earlier this weekend, would run off and hide from the rest of the field. But Allison is keeping step.
The leaders put a lap on Buddy Baker in car number 28. Still running in eighth position is Joe Ruttman from Upland, California. And a very interesting question was put to Joe. We asked him, what would you be if you were not a race driver?
I like to be a car owner and then tell that stupid driver what to do all the time, you know.
Joe Ruttman, the driver of car number 75. The leader of the Holly Farm 400, Darrell Waltrip. Second place belongs to Bobby Allison. Jeff Bodine is third, and Harry Gant is fourth.
You know we always got a like a cigarette rolled up in his T-shirt.
I'm my share of stock car racing. But even I don't have a chance if my car's not at the track. Our rig's that important. So we lease our truck from Saunders Leasing System.
Saunders is the oldest and among the largest truck leasing firms in the nation. They're the folks to talk to about leasing or renting trucks.
We got a lot riding on Saunders, because we can't win till they get us to the track.
Rent or lease from Saunders. Check your Yellow Pages or call toll-free.
Bobby Allison continues to pursue the leader, Darrell Waltrip. Here they come off of turn number four. Well, ESPN will present on October 16th live the CFL football game between Edmonton and Montreal from Olympic Stadium in Montreal, Quebec, Canada. Don Whitman and Leo Cahill report all the action October 16th at 1:30 p.m. Eastern Time, 10:30 a.m. Pacific Time, live on ESPN. Bobby Allison now right behind Darrell Waltrip down into turn number one. Allison has closed the few car length lead that he had, that Darrell Waltrip had on him as they go down the backstretch. Waltrip, it appears, is able to stave off the serious challenge, but Bobby Allison is hanging right in there waiting for the opportunity.
Well, as we watch the two leaders, here's what else is going on at this racetrack at this point. Jeff Bodine runs a comfortable third, not on the racetrack with anybody else. There's the second place car of Bobby Allison. He seems to be able to move in on Walter just a little bit in traffic, but then again, that's not all that surprising. There's still quite a lot of cars that fell out on the racetrack. Harry Gant runs in third position in the race
rather fourth position in the race right now. There are the current Winston Cup standings.
Allison and Waltrip battling it out on the racetrack. They're also battling it out in the battle for the Winston Cup. Allison has 3,574 points. Darrell Waltrip with 3,473. Terry Labonte, who was the leader at the halfway point of the season, is now third in the point standings with 3,372. Gant and Arrington are fourth and fifth. We'll talk more about the nice performance of Buddy Arrington a little bit later. Marcus is running in sixth place. Richard Petty is seventh. Dale Earnhardt eighth. Ron Bouchard ninth. And Ricky Rudd tenth in the battle for the Winston Cup. The winner of the Winston Cup at the end of the season will be awarded $75,000. Darrell Waltrip, Bobby Allison down the main straightaway. And as we have indicated earlier, these two cars have been running right together on the racetrack since the drop of the green flag. And now Bobby Allison, it appeared, was going to challenge for the lead to the inside, but could not get the job done. Now they move into some slower traffic in turns 3 and 4.
Bob, you and I have commented a couple of times in the last 2 or 3 broadcasts, mostly on the way home in a plane, that we haven't seen yet. And there they are, side by side. More on that in a second. The two leaders going at it, coming out of turn number 2. Allison finds an extra lane in the middle of the racetrack. Waltrip went high and gave him some room. Darrell Waltrip gave Bobby Allison some room, but Allison just did not have enough RPMs up as he came out of turn number 2, going down the backstretch to get around Waltrip. You and I have commented, we haven't seen yet this year, particularly in the second half of the season, a classic Waltrip-Allison duel. It seems like every race, either Waltrip is the dominant car or Allison is the dominant car. Could this be today? We see that 400-lap matchup, head-to-head, Waltrip versus Allison. Behind the first 4 cars, there's some interesting racing going on. And for those of you who follow NASCAR racing, again, as we continue to follow the leaders around right now, that's where the action is. Listen to the group that is in 5th through 10th. It's Labonte, and he's headed up. Labonte followed by number 3, Ricky Rudd, then Dale Earnhardt, Joe Ruttman, Tim Richmond, and Kyle Petty.
Now, Bobby Allison has been criticized at times for driving rather rough on these short tracks. He was criticized for some action at Richmond. We ask him about that.
Well, I think a little of that goes on in everybody's camp, and of course, there have been a couple occasions here where I was kind of put into a tight situation, and the outcome led to a little bit of controversy or dislike from some of the other guys. But it's kind of the same both ways. Those guys tend to forget that they do an awful lot of the same thing, and when the thing goes back the other way, they wonder about it. But it is kind of place where you really have to give and take a little bit. I think the key is just not to take too much.
Bobby Allison has had a good season so far. He and Darrell Waltrip are battling for the lead here in the Holly Farms 400. 65 laps have been completed. We'll have more live coverage from North Wilkesboro in a moment. The driver who started in 4th position in the Piedmont Airlines Pontiac is into the pit area, and it looks bad for this driver from Chesapeake, Virginia. Ricky Rudd, 26 years of age, has had a victory this year in Grand National competition, but it will not come that way today. While we were away also for that commercial break, we had a change of leader on the racetrack. The leader now is Bobby Allison, as he was able to sneak around Darrell Waltrip in some traffic. So Bobby Allison assumes the lead now. He becomes our second leader of the afternoon. Darrell Waltrip still hanging in there in second place. And there's quite a bit of real estate between the second place car and the third place car, driven by Jeff Bodine. The interval is about a full straightaway.
Well, Allison trailed Waltrip closely. He was stalking him for about 4 or 5 laps before he finally put his move on it. He drove very hard to get around Darrell, which surprised me a little bit. So we've got a long ways to go. This is 400 laps on this racetrack, and Allison just made his mind up that it was time for him to lead, and he worked very hard to get this position.
Sorry to see Ricky Rudd out of the competition. Ned Jarrett is with him.
Well, he crawled out of his Piedmont Airlines car number 3, Ricky, what went wrong?
Blew up on the front straightaway.
Well, it has to be awful disappointing here this close to home for the team.
Well, it is. We didn't run very long. The whole team, our crew, has been doing a good job. Just wish we could run the car and race all day long today.
Ricky, how
rather substantially in the last few laps. He has now moved up to fifth position.
Well, it was reported that what happened at Ruttman, who, remember, he started back in that pack with Dale Earnhardt and Richard Petty between like 15th and 20th starting positions, that when Ricky Rudd's engine blew, several other drivers in the top five slowed, fearing there might be some oil or water on the racetrack. And Ruttman found himself with an opening, decided to test the racetrack. And got to say, that was a successful experiment. Ruttman vaulted from eighth position up to fifth. He's been able to get around Earnhardt and Terry Labonte in addition to Ricky Rudd as a result of Rudd's blown engine.
Well, Ricky Rudd does not have a victory, as I alluded to a few minutes ago, on the Winston Cup Trail this year. However, he does have a pole position. He won the pole at the DRC Chemicals 500 in Dover, Delaware, a couple of weeks ago. So Ricky Rudd will be in that big race, the Busch Clash, at Daytona International Speedway this February. Richard Petty in car number 43 is working with Tim Richmond in car number 2 and Buddy Baker. Of course, Richard Petty has won $199,622 in 42 starts.
Petty, who runs right now behind Tim Richmond, you just saw them get away from Buddy Baker. Baker is not on the lead lap. We still have about 15 cars on the lead lap, and Buddy Baker, unfortunately, is not one of them. Richard Petty, the man who, a lot has been said about him. Petty, a little bit out of shape coming out of turn number 4. Racing with Tim Richmond on the track. A lot has been said about Richard Petty not going after the pole in Grand National qualifying, and it has been some time since Richard has qualified in the pole, but did you happen to know who has the most poles in the history of Grand National Stock Car Racing? Yep, you might have guessed it, that STP Orange and Petty Blue, number 43, Richard Petty. 123 times he has been the fastest qualifier.
Allison and Waltrip on the racetrack. Bobby with the lead, Darrell right behind him. We have completed 81 laps now. Several cars have dropped out of competition. J.D. McDuffie out of the race, so is Ronnie Thomas, Joel Stowe, Ricky Rudd, Jimmy Walker, and also the number 77 of Dean Combs out of competition. As they race down the front straightaway, Bobby Allison maintaining just a very slight advantage on Darrell Waltrip into turn number 1. Waltrip looking like he wanted to go to the inside of Allison that time. Could not get the job done. Now Bobby Allison stretches out the advantage just a little bit as they go down the backstretch. They move high to go around the number 24 of Cecil Gordon from South Hill, Virginia. Cecil driving the number 24 car here this afternoon. And once again into turn number 1. Now they move to the high side to put a lap on Jeff McDuffie in car number 7. His father, J.D. McDuffie, already out of the competition, but Jeff's still in there. One of two father and son combinations in this race this afternoon. The other, of course, Kyle and Richard Petty.
These two leaders, you might think that they're driving the rest of the field into the ground because we haven't been able to talk about third or fourth place. They haven't been close. But I'll tell you something, Jeff Levine's keeping up. And look at this battle on the racetrack between Richard Petty, Tim Richmond, and Mark Martin. Now, Martin is a lap down to both Richmond and Petty, who run in the top 10. Remember, so is Buddy Baker. But Richard Petty has really been putting the heat on Tim Richmond.
So we continue to watch all kinds of racing out there on the race as we present live the Holly Farms 400. From North Wilkesboro, North Carolina, the leader continuing to be Bobby Allison, one of two leaders we have had in the competition so far today.
And here come the leaders moving up, getting ready to challenge Richmond and Richard Petty. And that could be tough, getting around the two of those. They're running in 9th and 10th unofficially at this moment on the track. And when you start lapping the top 10, that's tough.
Darrell Walter moved to the inside to put another lap on Buddy Baker. We'll be back with more live coverage here in just a moment from North Wilkesboro, North Carolina.
I do a lot of weekend driving in pretty heavy traffic, and everything's riding on my Goodyears. These racing tires give me the kind of handling I need. During the week,
I count on Goodyear Street Radio, because on the track or off, I feel better with the blimp behind me.
Get the blimp behind you. Come up to Goodyear.
You don't have to be a hotshot driver to have a big following.
The art of hand carving, rarely found in this day and
age. All kinds of race fans, all sizes of race fans. This young man is a Harry Gant fan, and he has the driver's uniform to prove it.
Harry Gant, who currently runs in fourth place in this race, maybe Harry's youngest and most loyal race fan. We understand that that young man's mother went to a great deal of effort to get that suit custom made to resemble the suit that the full size and the real Harry Grant donned.
10 cars are running on the lead lap. These are the cars out of the race. J.D. McDuffie, Dean Combs, Jimmy Walker, Ronnie Thomas, and Ricky Rudd. Right ahead of our leader, Bobby Allison, is the 10th place car driven by Richard Petty. And right ahead of him, the 9th place car driven by Tim Richmond. Down the main straightaway, the number 88 Gatorade Chevrolet driven by Bobby Allison continues to lead this race. We have completed now 91 laps, so we are nearing the 1/4 mark here. The 400 laps will make up this contest.
You know, you go to Grand National Race week after week after week, and you watch the dominance, particularly this year, of those two cars, the Junior Johnson Mountain Dew crew of Darrell Waltrip and the Gary Nelson-headed Gatorade crew of Bobby Allison. It is marvelous, really, how dominant these two drivers can be and these two teams can be. You have to shake your head. You know the other crews are working just as hard as the two of them, but something clicks for certain teams during certain seasons, and they become almost invincible. And we've had two teams that have become invincible in the 1982 season. And if what has happened up till now and the performance so far in this race is any indication, we could have a good old-fashioned Western shootout from here to the end of the season between these two drivers.
Kyle Petty, driving car number 42, has improved his position. He has gotten around Terry Labonte. So Kyle Petty now is in 7th position. His father, Richard, is in 10th, and Richard now is one lap down because Allison went around him, as you saw just a few minutes ago, on the backstretch. Kyle Petty, the driver of car number 42, he is 22 years of age, driving the STP Uno Pontiac. Kyle, of course, from Randleman, North Carolina, started 13th in this race, and he moved to the outside to put a lap on the number 48 car, driven by James Hilton from Inman, South Carolina.
Yep, he hasn't rented it out this weekend. That's good old James, one of the million-dollar winners in career winnings at NASCAR Racing, who drives his own car, the Palatine Chevrolet. Kyle Petty, the third generation of Petty Racing. Of course, his grandfather, Lee Petty, absolutely one of the pillars of not only stock car racing, but of automobile racing in this country. One of those fellows who just after World War II decided to take a chance on this new sport they were putting together down here in the South. They called it stock car racing, a participant in the first ever Grand National Stock Car Race held, a participant in the first ever Southern 500, the first race in the history of automobile racing, completed on a super speedway race. Lee Petty, followed by Richard Petty, and now Kyle Petty. And make no mistake about it, Kyle Petty has shown great promise. Interestingly enough, some of his finest performances have come on the big racetracks. And right now, he's going after Tim Richmond, who's been a competitive top 10 all afternoon. But look who's knocking at the back door. The leaders are coming around. Bobby Allison has already gotten by. Here comes Waltrip.
So on the backstretch, it is Bobby Allison, then Tim Richmond, Richard Petty, and Darrell Waltrip, but only two cars of that group on the lead lap, Bobby Allison and Darrell Waltrip. ESPN presents another track back.
The seatbelt system is a little different in a NASCAR Winston Cup car than we have in our street cars. They have what they call a five-point hookup, and with one quick release, they can unhook all of them. That's the seat belts, the shoulder harness, and the submarine belt. This helps to keep the driver a lot safer when he's out there zipping around. You know, I believe I can still do this.
And you know, there are a few of us who would like to see that, too. Thousands of spectators are looking on here as the Brushy Mountains loom in the background over North Wilkesboro. We'll be back in just a moment with 100 laps completed. Tough season. Darrell Waltrip has led the most laps, 2,357. Bobby Allison has led 1,827 laps. Dale Earnhardt, 1,007. Cale Yarborough has led 348 laps, and Harry Gant has led 325. Now, a special award is presented by the Gillette Atra people at the end of the season for the driver who leads the most laps during the racing season.
Well, Waltrip's total of 2,357 laps out of a possible 700, or rather 7,200 laps that he has led means he's led about one out of every three laps he's raced. Is just an incredible figure. The interesting figure there is Dale Earnhardt, with just the lone win at Darlington early this year, is third on the leaderboard in terms of number of laps. Only three drivers have led more than 1,000 laps in 1982.
Seven cars are on the lead lap. Bobby Allison is the leader. Second place belongs to Darrell Waltrip. And one of the drivers doing a very good job out there is running in fifth place. That is Joe Ruttman, car number 75.
Well, Ruttman has had a really tough time of it the last couple of months. They've had all kinds of problems with the race car. Joe has become the king of second-day qualifying on the Grand National Trail. Several times this season, he's been the fastest qualifier in the second day. Of course, the second day doesn't move you into the top 10 because the way the qualifying structure is set up in NASCAR, the fastest 20 qualifiers in most instances start up front. But Joe Ruttman's had all kinds of tough luck. He started in, you guessed it, 17th position here this week in North Wilkesboro, but he's done an excellent job of moving up to the pack. Most recently, in the last 15 laps, he's disposed of Kyle Petty, Tim Richmond, Terry Labonte, and Dale Earnhardt to keep himself on the lead lap with our two leaders, Allison and Waltrip, and they are not gaining any ground on Joe. Joe is about two-thirds of a lap behind the leader, Bobby Allison, but they're not pulling away. Ruttman appears to be running just about as fast right now as leader Allison, but then again, Allison and Waltrip with still considerably more than 300 laps to go. They may be just kind of cooling it for a while.
Joe Ruttman is 16th in the point standings at this time. He has 2,409 points. This is his 24th race of the year, and he has won a total of $137,490. As we indicated earlier, he finished third in the Daytona 500. That his best finish of 1982. Buddy Baker, car number 28, rolls to a stop in his pit area. Buddy driving the Stacy Pontiac. He hails from Charlotte, North Carolina, 41 years of age, a veteran on the NASCAR circuit, and tires being changed on the right side of the car. The fuel going into the car also. Morgan Shepherd also in for a pit stop in car number 98, and it's about that time that we'll start to see a series of pit stops.
Yeah, the cars are capable of going, about 100 miles if they so chose to go that far, but we were, of course, well aware that at this racetrack, you pit more for tires than you do for fuel. A lot of the top teams, you get to this part of the race, if they're not performing the way they feel as though they should be, they may stop a little earlier. But Buddy Baker, his problems are obviously more severe, and it's not just a routine pit stop. As a crew member has climbed inside the race car, might be an ignition problem, might be something perhaps wrong with the clutch inside that machine. Usually when you go inside like that, it's something other than a motor problem.
It could also be an ignition problem, the word we get from the pit area. There was frantic work being done on that car when Buddy brought it in. It looked like it was going to be a routine stop, but then the crew member climbed inside the cockpit with Buddy, and you can see Buddy taking his helmet off now. He's got a smile on his face. He doesn't appear to be too unhappy, but it looks like it's over for Buddy Baker here in North Wilkesboro.
It's a heck of a lot easier to drop out when you're 20th than when you're leading.
Bobby Allison in car number 8 puts a lap on Dale Earnhardt, who is running in the top 10. So Bobby Allison and Darrell Waltrip are still running pretty close together on the racetrack. Darrell Waltrip moves to the high groove and attempts to go around Dale Earnhardt on the outside off of turn number 4 onto the straightaway, and Waltrip will pass Dale Earnhardt.
Now watch Kyle Petty. Kyle Petty's going to try and sneak around the high side of Earnhardt, too. Kyle's been racing with him. Dale has given Darrell just a little bit of room, and Kyle's going to try and sneak by, but I think Darrell's onto the game.
Here's Ned Jarrett in the pit area.
Buddy Baker has crawled out of the car number 28. Buddy, what went wrong?
Something wrong with the clutch. It won't go in gear, it won't go out. When you do get in gear and you hit the starter, it just keep running in that gear and you can't change gears. So I went to the parking.
You never did really get the car to work in here the way that this car normally runs.
We had run all week and we didn't run today. It's just been one of those bad days for us. And all I can tell you is next week in Charlotte, we won't look like it.
Buddy Baker started in 18th position here this afternoon, qualifying at 110.603 miles an hour.
And his reference to, I guarantee you, we won't look like this next week. He likes the big racetracks, and Buddy is very good when the tracks are super fast.
And with 119 laps completed, the leader continues to be Bobby Allison, and trouble coming from the Dale Earnhardt car as the yellow comes out.
Well, Dale has been down in the grass as he came down the front stretch that time. He's got something long trailing from the racetrack. There's some debris caught in the race car. See that black speck trailing Dale Earnhardt by about a car length? There's a piece of cord. It certainly couldn't be a strand of grass that's that long, but it's trailing along behind Dale Earnhardt, who's been down in the grass, reminiscent of what happened back in the spring, Bob.
That is exactly right. He spun down in turns 3 and 4. During the very early stages of the Northwestern Bank 400 here at North Wilkesboro. And with this caution period, we do have a series of pit stops being made. Bobby Allison in. in at car number 88 and away in 13.7 seconds. Also, the fifth-place car driven by Joe Ruttman is in for routine maintenance. The changing tires on the right side of that car. There is the object that's trailing the Earnhardt car that you mentioned, Larry.
Well, I have no idea what it could be, but I'll tell you, if that is a piece of grass, that's the longest and toughest strand of grass I've ever seen.
Well, maybe Dale got married out there and we were unaware of it, and he has streamers trailing from his car. At any rate, he comes down through the pit area now, and his crew will be checking to see exactly what that is. Here he is pulling to a stop right in front of us at the start-finish line. The crew goes to work on the right side of the car, changing the tires, fuel being put in also, and nobody seems to be paying much attention to that object that's dragging. Meanwhile, Darrell Waltrip, a number 11, the car that was running in second position, also in.
The main man, as we look at Darrell Waltrip, the main man in Dale Earnhardt's crew, Bud Moore, is the guy who very casually walked around to the tail of the car. He had some tin snips and just walked behind and cut it off. He wasn't in a rush about it or anything. He was very casual about it, as a matter of fact.
Well, all the leaders in, including Bobby Allison for a second time. The Petty's in, so is Tim Richmond, so is Mark Martin. But everybody back out there right now. Jeff Bodine, who's running in the top five, also made a pit stop back out there right now. So we are under our second caution period of the afternoon because of an incident involving Dale Earnhardt. Back with more in a moment.
Here comes Harry Gant and the Skull Bandit in for a pit stop.
Hi, I'm Harry Gant. When I bring the Skull Bandit in for a pit stop, I come in for a paint stop, because while the rest of the team takes care of the Bandit, I get to take a little pinch of Skull, put it between my cheek and gum for real tobacco pleasure without lighting up. Now that's what we call teamwork, and Skull's what we call team pleasure. For real tobacco pleasure without lighting up, try Skull. A pinch is all it takes.
Firenza S. It's what a small car can be when it's an Oldsmobile. Front wheel drive, electronic fuel injection, available overhead cam engine.
Man, that's some kind of car.
New Firenza S. Have one built for you.
There is Dale Earnhardt in car number 15. He is the reason for this caution period that we are under right now. He spun, and he also had a problem on April 18th. We were here in North Wilkesboro last time. Let's go back and see the highlights of that race here at North Wilkesboro, April 18th. When we were here at North Wilkesboro on April 18th for the Northwestern Bank 400, Dale Earnhardt spun in turn number 3 and brought out the first yellow flag. That occurred on lap number 10. Earnhardt was coming off a win at the Rebel 500 in Darlington. He had started 14th in the North Wilkesboro race, but he fought his way back and led laps 139 through 148. Then Darrell Waltrip, who had won at Bristol and Atlanta, reassumed the lead and went on to win his third race in the still early 1982 Winston Cup season. Just two laps from the finish, Terry Labonte and Bobby Allison got together in turn number 3, a perfect example of what can happen on a short track in NASCAR competition. Allison was two laps down at the time. Labonte was running second. He wound up getting the worst end of the deal with damage to the right side of his car. You can see that Earnhardt was ahead of Labonte here, but the NASCAR official said that Terry was able to maintain sufficient yellow speed. He was awarded second position, and Dale Earnhardt wound up third. That was here in April. Meanwhile, the green flag has come out once again, and we are back to racing on lap 126. Allison, Waltrip, and Gant running right together on the racetrack. Jeff Bodine is running in fourth position. And the racing continuing now. Darrell Waltrip going high in turn number 3. Looks like he would like to take the lead, but Harry Gant is looking strong, trying to get to the inside of Darrell Waltrip.
And right behind them is Joe Ruttman. Unless Ruttman lost the lap in the pit, Joe Ruttman in the Pet Dairies blue and white number 75 should be in fourth. That would put Bodine in fifth, but five cars prior to the pit stop on the lead lap. All sorts of strange things can happen on those pit stops, and we're checking right now with NASCAR scoring to determine whether or not those five drivers, the four you're looking at there, Allison, Waltrip, Gantt, and Ruttman, as well as Jeff Bodine, are indeed on the lead lap.
Good racing, especially for second position here. Harry Gantt to the inside and Darrell Waltrip to the outside. Now Gantt falls back into third, but right behind Harry Gantt is Joe Ruttman in car number 75. Well, Ned Jarrett is down in the pit area and has moved over to Bud Moore. Ned?
Of course, on the car number 15 today, Dale Earnhardt. What went wrong out there?
Him and Tom Petty got tangled up in the third and fourth quarter and knocked the toe out. So we adjusted the toe. We just hope we got it right.
Okay, he said the toe end was knocked out, but now they think that everything is okay.
All right, we might explain what the toe end is on a car, Larry.
Well, the race cars, of course, the tires, it's important that they're pointed in the right direction. They can adjust that per racetrack, depending upon the size and shape of the racetrack. You want those tires to be pointed properly. That's an adjustment that has to be made every time.
130 laps have been completed. It is still Bobby Allison and Darrell Waltrip battling for the lead. Waltrip led the first 67 laps, then Bobby Allison took over the lead, and they have been the only two leaders in our competition so far. Allison and Waltrip, 1 and 2. Harry Gantt running in third place. Joe Ruttman, fourth. Terry Labonte, fifth. Jeff Bodine is in sixth position. Seventh position belonging to Kyle Petty.
And we just did get our confirmation that Terry Labonte is the only one among those drivers running near the pack that, or near the front, that is a lap down. So Labonte, he was lapped. Remember, Labonte slowed down a little bit compared to the other top runners between laps 20 and 40. They didn't have just the right setup. Maybe the tires they put on weren't working properly. But whatever the case, Labonte wasn't able to go as quick as he normally is. And unfortunately, that first green flag segment went a long time. And it went too long for Terry Labonte. He was lapped under racing speed conditions during about lap 70. So Labonte's down a lap, but it is Allison, Waltrip, Gantt, Joe Ruttman, and Jeff Bodine. Those are the five cars and the only five to this point on the leader's lap.
134 laps have been completed, and Larry, these two drivers have been running out there nose to tail and side by side for the last few laps, but it's awfully early in the race, and I'm sure that Darrell Waltrip is in no real big hurry to move into the lead, although you do get points for being in the lead. He's just making sure that he stays very close to Bobby Allison, and when the time is right, maybe make his move.
Well, of course, both of them have already led. As we look at first position, Bobby Allison. Allison and Waltrip have led about, I guess they'd share this. There is the second place car of Darrell Waltrip chasing in points. In third place is Harry Gantt. He's been right up there all afternoon, still looking for his first win on a big track, although he did win earlier this year at Martinsville, a racetrack not that dissimilar from this one. The first three cars continue to be, just like a videotape replay, Bobby Allison, Darrell Waltrip, and Harry Gantt. They're all green and white.
And we will continue our live coverage as ESPN's Auto Racing 82 season is here in North Wilkesboro, North Carolina for the Holly Farms 400.
This by Mobile One, the oil that saves you gas and more.
Allison is in trouble. Seconds ago, smoke started pouring from that car. You can see him fighting it to keep it on the racetrack. It looks like he has blown an engine, oil possibly on the racetrack. He did a nice job of keeping it under control, but Bobby Allison brings out a caution flag, and it's all over for Bobby Allison.
Well, it certainly looks terminal, although it's a little unusual to see that much oil come out of one of these Grand National cars because of the way they're constructed. Simply because of a blown engine. For a while, I thought it might have been an oil line that popped off, or maybe something in the radiator, maybe overheating. But then the smoke began to pour out of the exhaust pipes as he was going down the backstretch. And then, as you pointed out, Bob, it really let go right in front of Joe Ruttman, too, as he went into turn number three and turn number four. But Bobby, he continues to sit in their race car. They still have at least a little bit of hope as maybe they might get this car back up. There's Waltrip immediately looking for upstairs. He wants to get out of that way.
And Ned Jarrett is already there with Bobby.
Well, Bobby gets himself a drink of Gatorade, but that's not too consoling right now. Bobby, what went wrong there?
Something happened to the engine. I'm not sure what.
Bobby's equipment unhooked. We'll get back to him in just a moment. I'm sorry.
got a little slick there, but the car really drives good, and I just did the best I could. It was too late for anything then, but just to save a mess out there.
Well, Bobby, I know that you really hate to be out this early with that Winston Cup point man.
Well, still the guys are doing a great effort, and that's racing. Some days you have tough days, and some days you do okay. So we'll have to look for better days.
Well, Bobby Allison with disappointment written all over his face, but still manages to compliment the crew that did a tremendous job preparing the car. And certainly the battle for the Winston Cup now will really tighten up because Darrell Walter, who is in second place in the point standings, is still out on the track and, as a matter of fact, is the leader.
And he had about a 100-point deficit to make up on Bobby Allison. You know, Bobby a little while ago said that if he did not get the championship this year, that he's had so many successes and so much fun driving race cars in his career that he felt that he could live with it, but it was pretty obvious when he climbed out of that race car that was on his mind, because you normally don't see Bobby Allison that quiet and that disappointed about dropping out of a race.
Terry Labonte is back in the pits, and they have the hood up on that car. It looks pretty bad for Terry and Darrell Waltrip. Dale Earnhardt, rather, making a quick stop. We'll be right back. ESPN Sports Center, weeknights at 7:30. A lot going on in the world of sports with the baseball season winding down. And, of course, the auto racing season also winding to a close. And besides that, some Davis Cup action. And those people that we had on the screen there just a few minutes ago, they have a tremendous view. They are located just inside of turn number one.
Yeah, but they're in trouble if that pole catches on fire.
At the Holly Farms 400, we have completed 146 laps. We are under our third caution period of the afternoon. The first was brought out by a blown engine on the number 70 car of J.D. McDuffie. Then Dale Earnhardt spun on lap number 120. And just a few laps ago, Bobby Allison's engine let go. And Bobby is out of the race after leading more than 60 laps. Now we go back to green with the lead being held by Darrell Waltrip. Second position belongs to Harry Gant, and third is Jeff Bonine.
And in fourth place is Joe Ruttman on the right-hand side of your screen, the far right-hand side there momentarily. Ruttman was the only of the now four cars on the lead lap who pitted for fresh rubber during that stop. There goes Ruttman to the inside of Bodine. That's third and fourth place side-by-side and out of shape coming off the fourth turn with Kyle Petty momentarily. Caused a lot of a shuffling going on behind him. You saw Ruttman dart down to the inside coming down the front stretch, but everybody survived. Ruttman with brand new rubber. He hopes to be able to go to the front. Now, of course, it can backfire on you also.
Replay. Look at Petty's back end come around on him. He nearly lost control of that car. Morgan Shepherd had to get on the brakes very hard. Joe Ruttman takes to the inside to avoid the melee and did a nice job avoiding the situation. Jeff Bodine, meanwhile, was able to go to the high side of the racetrack and maintain fourth place, rather third place.
And look who's right in front of Bodine and Ruttman. Somehow, Kyle Petty stayed in the throttle, took her on down into number one, and came out on top. Kyle is running loose. They recently made, of course, tire changes on that car, too. And I don't think Kyle got quite the setup that he had earlier in the race. That car is dirt tracking certain times around this speedway.
And his best finish was in Dover, Delaware earlier this year. He finished in second position, was in a very good position to win that, but had to settle for second. Darrell Waltrip continues to be the leader. Right behind him now, the number 33 7-Eleven Skoal Bandit Buick, driven by Harry Gant from very close by North Wilkesboro. Harry lives in Taylorsville, North Carolina. It's about 30 miles from here.
Matter of fact, if you play your cards right, Bob, didn't have to catch a plane, you could go down to the local steakhouse in Taylorsville and eat on Harry. Are you listening, Harry?
Well, Kyle Petty, without doubt, is having some handling problems out there. So you can get clues coming out of turn number four. First two cars, though, running very well out there. Darrell Waltrip and Harry Gant. Third position now belongs to Joe Ruttman, as Ruttman was able to pass Jeff Bodine. So Ruttman now in third. Bodine is in fourth position. And fifth is Kyle Petty, who is a lap down.
Well, if you're anybody but Harry Gant, because you're right behind Waltrip, you might be feeling kind of racy and think you got a shot at this guy. They are about a straightaway ahead of everybody, and if you are among those who are at least a straightaway behind, you've got to be worried, because you know that Waltrip is cooled it a little bit. His biggest rival, Bobby Allison, is out of it now. As we look at that pack of cars led by Joe Ruttman going into turn one, Drummond running third. Kyle Petty in the number 42 car is one lap down. Jeff Bodine in the number 50 car right there leading there into turn number three is on the lead lap of the leaders, runs in fourth position. But Waltrip, you got to figure he's a little bit off the pace right now, but he's still leading this race, and he looks very dominant right now. Now Kyle Petty, it appears, is backing off a little bit. He has lost the position as Terry Labonte is able to get around. Now he and his father, Richard Petty, are running nose to tail on the racetrack in the backstretch. So Kyle Petty's handling problems obviously causing him to get off the pace just a little bit. Behind Richard Petty is Dale Earnhardt and Tim Richmond, Morgan Shepherd, Ron Bouchard also running in this pack of cars into turn number one. Talking a little bit about this racetrack, let's follow Bodine and Labonte as they battle around. They're going uphill now down the backstretch. You can go very hard into turn number three because, remember, it's like having a 20 or 25-degree bank to turns three and four. There's the front stretch. You're going downhill. The cars will wash up about one or one and a half car widths. You see, they're not right down exactly in the bottom of the track. If you're hooked up real well, you can pass on the inside through turns one and two. But it's pretty tricky down there.
Very unusual racetrack indeed, where there is a very distinct difference. As you go down the backstretch, you're actually going uphill by some 11 feet. Continue to watch Jeff Bodine, Terry Labonte, and Kyle Petty. Labonte has been in for several pit stops today, and they have raised the hood on the car each time, but he's still out there in competition, although he's several laps down. Jeff Bodine, car number 50, is running in third place and is one of three cars on the lead lap.
Bodine continues to try and hold off Terry Labonte. Remember, Labonte's a lap down to Jeff Bodine. Labonte running much quicker since he got this new set of rubber. He picked up about lap number 120 or so. And Labonte gets around Bodine, but he still has got at least a quarter of a lap before he can get him back around. Waltrip, who leads the race, Labonte would certainly like to get back on the lead lap because, as everybody knows, you can't win a race unless you're on the lead lap.
Terry Labonte in the Stratigraph Texas Sheen Chevy. Terry used to be from Corpus Christi, Texas, now from Archdale, North Carolina. Back in a moment with more of the Holly Farms 400. The record for 400 laps here in North Wilkesboro set back in 1978 by Cale Yarborough at 97.847 miles an hour. Right now, the average speed of the race is just under 95 miles an hour. Dave Marcus with the one-lap qualifying record at 115.485 miles an hour. And the two-day average qualifying record is 114.801 miles per hour. Joe Ruttman is in fourth place. We will back up and show you the leader here. Darrell Waltrip in car number 11 is the leader. Now, we have been watching Joe Ruttman on the racetrack in the last few laps, and it appears to us that Joe Ruttman is the fastest car on the racetrack. We're going to see if he's traveling faster than Darrell Waltrip. Here comes Darrell into turn number four on the main straightaway. We're timing the lap with Darrell Waltrip. Crosses the start-finish line, and the lap is 21.2 unofficially. Now we're going to time Joe Ruttman, who is running in third position and is one of four cars on the lead lap. Besides Darrell Waltrip, Harry Gant is running in second. Joe Ruttman's in third, and in fourth position is Jeff Bodine. Larry, you claim that Ruttman is running faster than Darrell Waltrip. We're going to check out and see how accurate you are as Ruttman crosses the finish line and starts our clock.
Well, I was catching him in a handheld stopwatch a few laps ago, and he had broken from the pack finally. And when he first broke from the pack, he was 3.5 seconds behind Waltrip. And then I watched the next lap go by. He was 3.4, then it went to 3.2, and he got down to within 3 seconds of Darrell.
21.3 seconds for Joe Ruttman, and Allison's lap was 20, or rather, Waltrip's lap was 21.2 seconds, so you were at least close.
Well, operator error could have caused that. That was at least 2/10 of a second.
170 laps have been completed. Darrell Waltrip continues to be the leader. There is the interval between Waltrip and second place Harry Gant in the number 33 car down the backstretch. And there is Stevie Waltrip, who is always in Darrell's pit and always keeping the charge and the stopwatches for her husband. And it's been a very successful year so far for Darrell Waltrip, as on 9 different occasions, Darrell Waltrip has visited Victory Lane. Bobby Allison, second as far as wins are concerned this year, with 7.
Well, we have have a host of drivers who are one lap behind to this man as they are to three other drivers. But if you're a Grand National fan, we hope your favorite is among these guys. Labonte, both Kyle and Richard. Tim Richmond, Dale Earnhardt, despite his spin, is in seventh, eighth position at this point, one lap down. Jody Ridley, Ron Bouchard, Lake Speedy, Dave Marcus, and Morgan Shepherd. All those people unofficially just one lap down, and they could still be in it. We're not even halfway through this race. 400 laps on a 5/8 mile racetrack.
And yes, there is another Waltrip that is a race driver. Daryl's brother, Mike, sat on the pole here yesterday in an international sedan race. He did not fare too well in the competition itself. He spun a couple of times, but certainly Mike Waltrip is a name to remember in the coming years in auto racing.
2 years as a racing driver, 25 entries, approximately 7 victories already.
And Richard Petty racing with his son Kyle on the North Wilkesboro 5/8 mile oval. Richard in the number 43 car and Kyle in 42. These guys were not the only father-son combination out there today. J.D. McDuffie and Jeff McDuffie, also father and son combination. Both of those guys were on the back row of this race, starting in the 15th row. And already J.D. McDuffie has dropped out of competition, but his son Jeff is still out there. And Richard Petty and Kyle Petty running together on the back stretch.
And as you look at the Petties, you just have to think about the history of Grand National Racing. There's Jeff McDuffie in his third career start only as a Grand National stock car driver. Started with a comment that of all the Grand National racetracks, certainly North Wilkesboro is one of the most historic. Remember, this is Jeff's third race in this J.D. McDuffie prepared race car. Both of the other two races that Jeff has been in were right here at North Wilkesboro. There is young Jeff McDuffie, just 21 years of age, driving the Bailey Excavating Pontiac here at North Wilkesboro.
And he started 30th, qualifying at 106.398 miles an hour. Well, we'll be right back with more of this live race today with Daryl Waltrip still the leader.
Datsun 200SX. Here's blistering acceleration that left 70 other cars behind in this toughest of all rallies. Datsun 200SX. Twin-ignited hemi-head muscle wrapped in power styling. Datsun 200SX. Drive this fuel-injected beauty and you drive a winner. Proven from Mombasa to Main Street.
Datsun, we own.
From the depths of space, from the edge of the earth, Timex takes quartz to make a watch beyond time as we know it. The Timex quartz, quartz for every man, handsome in the newest ways, so accurate you may have to reset it only once this year. Thin, sleek, elegant. The Timex quartz, built and priced in the Timex tradition. Timex, we make technology beautiful.
Richard Petty has won more times in this particular race, 5. Dale Yarborough is second with 3 wins. Marvin Tench has 2 wins in the Holly Farms 400. Bobby Allison has 2, and Daryl Waltrip also has 2 wins.
Well, not only is Richard the all-time leader of wins at this race, but also at this racetrack, he has won 15 times of the 42 Grand National races held here in the history of Grand National racing in North Wilkesboro. Of course, it's not all that surprising to find Richard Petty to be the leading winner at a racetrack of the 16 tracks currently active. Petty, for you aficionados, take a quick guess, is the all-time leading winner on 10 of the 16. So Richard has spread around the wealth a little bit in those 195 career wins.
Jeff Bodine, car number 50, is in fourth position and the only other driver, the fourth driver on the lead lap. And Jeff Bodine has gone to the open face helmet, and we ask him why he changed.
Well, I guess, Ned, basically just to conform. It was a little different than what everyone else runs. And it looked a little strange out there, and I was getting a little static from everybody about wearing the helmet. Some people think you can't see out of that type of helmet. You can, there's no problem with vision, but It was a little different. We just decided to perform. Bell came up with a helmet for us, and we decided to wear it. Plus, these open-face helmets are cooler. That full-face helmet, you drop the shield on it that's in front of your eyes, and it does get pretty warm in there. And at the time, I was wearing glasses, and it was hard to wear glasses with that helmet. So we just decided we'd switch and go to this Bell open-face helmet.
Jeff placed fourth in the Dover race, which was held a couple of weeks ago. He is now running fourth here at the Holly Farms 400. Third place, Joe Ruttman. Second is Harry Gant. And the leader continues to be Darrell Waltrip. And we go back down to the pit area with Ned Jarrett, who has the chief mechanic on the Harry Gant car.
Travis Carter, who is the team manager and crew chief. Travis, I thought you made an adjustment on that pit stop, but you did not make the safety adjustment on it.
Has recovered from a spin very early in the competition and is running in the top 10. He moves up another position by passing Kyle Petty. So Bouchard running well in that number 47, Stacy Buick. Ron Bouchard, the only rookie to ever win a super speedway race in Grand National competition, was only his 11th race ever in the GN cars. Other rookies have won Grand National races. Way back in 58, Shorty Rollins pulled the trick. Earl Ross won one. Dale Earnhardt, so did Morgan Shepherd also last year. But Bouchard still stands as the only Cairo to ever win a super speedway race in his first year on the trail. Ronnie Bouchard, one of the most outstanding short track drivers perhaps of all time, particularly in the Northeast.
Earnhardt in car number 15, who also spun early in the competition, is back up to speed. Following Dale Earnhardt on the racetrack is the number 17 of Lake Speed. And Lake qualified at 112.714 miles an hour. The qualifying procedure here in North Wilkesboro is quite different from a lot of the racetracks. What they do is average 2 days of competition. They qualified on Friday, and then they also qualified on Saturday, and they averaged the two speeds turned in by a driver, and the average speed is the speed that they use to determine a starting position. And Lake started in 10th position in this race. He's driving the Yazoo Moores Pontiac. Lake is from Jackson, Mississippi.
Well, Lake Speed is having a good weekend. Right now, he is only one lap down to the leaders. He is in 10th position, having an excellent weekend in the Yazoo Moores number 17. There is also another sponsor on the side of that car. Actually, on the trunk, it's called the Loading Zone. And I guess you have to be from North Wilkes to know what the Loading Zone is. It's a local establishment that serves beverages. The Loading Zone of North Wilkesboro, North Carolina.
Several cars have dropped out of competition as we near the halfway point. Those cars who have dropped by the wayside include J.D. McDuffie in car number 70. Also out of the race, Dean Combs in car 77. Jimmy Walker is out in car number 96. Ronnie Thomas is out of the race in car number 25. Also out of the race, Ricky Rudd, Buddy Baker, Joel Stowe, and Bobby Allison, who was leading on lap number 140 when the engine gave way and Bobby Allison called it a day. At that point, Darrell Waltrip took over the lead and has been leading since. 198 laps have been completed, very close to the halfway point. And some race fans look on from their campers, from the grandstand, from all over this 5/8 mile racetrack, and they're seeing some great competition here today. We'll continue to cover it in a moment.
Ways don't understand. October's fall harvest promises plenty of sports on ESPN. Sunday's your ticket to live NBA action as we tip off our first season of pro hoop coverage. And October takes you down under for live Davis Cup play, where the U.S. looks to get by Australia and advance to the finals. For boxing fans, Saturday Night at the Fights continues, featuring some of boxing's biggest stars. October means more college football, with Notre Dame, Penn State, and Pitt on tap. And the magic show comes east when the world champion L.A. Lakers meet the New Jersey Nets in the NBA Hall of Fame game live. October offerings include NASCAR's Holly Farms 400, plus the American 500. There's more exciting CFL action. We'll visit Italy for the WCT Fall Finals. Don't forget our regulars, top-ranked boxing, the NFL Game of the Week, and PKA Karate. October features an Inside Baseball World Series special, also a new edition, NFL Theater. October is packed with sports anytime on ESPN.
So far this year on the 1982 Grand National Trail, Darrell Waltrip has won the most money, $543,460. Bobby Allison second in money winnings with $484,900. Richard Petty has won $319,200. Dale Earnhardt has $313,000. And Ron Bouchard, Jody Ridley, Benny Parsons, Cale Yarborough, and Buddy Baker in the second 10. And Darrell Waltrip stands to add to his earnings today if he can continue to lead the official starter for the NASCAR Grand National Circuit. Harold Kinder has just shown the drivers cross flags indicating half of the race has been completed.
Well, last year NASCAR set a record for a racing division, had 22 drivers who won more than $100,000. They are already at 22 for the 1982 season, and there are four drivers who are well above 90,000 and have an opportunity to go over 100. Mark Martin, Lake Speed, J.D. McDuffie, and Tommy Gale. There is Lake, or make that DK Ulrich in car number 6 on the racetrack right now with Kyle Petty in car number 42. DK, driving the Pentax Cameras car, has an unusual person on the pit radio. It's a young lady whom DK communicates with when he's out on the racetrack. DK, of course, is the car that a lot of other drivers have been in several times this season. We saw that car involved in a spectacular crash at the Michigan International Speedway on the backstretch earlier this year on ESPN. But DK has been the owner of it all season long. Of course, DK also had his car leased out to quite a number of drivers last year. He began the 1981 season fielding the steady ride for Tim Richmond. That arrangement did not work out. And DK, you know, he has stated in the past that he would like to field the car, would like to be a team manager. You still get the idea that he likes stepping behind the wheel also and driving now and then. Sandy Jones has moved over to DK's car to be the crew chief on the Pentax camera machine. DK, at 38 years of age, has become one of the real steady and regular entries in Grand National Racing.
Al Acquasto was the driver of the car when that accident occurred that you referred to at the Michigan International Speedway. DK driving it here this weekend. He is 38 years of age and hails from Harrisburg, North Carolina. Started 25th in the race today at 108.319 miles an hour qualifying speed. Darrell Waltrip is the leader of this race, and the lead that he has on second place Harry Gant is about 10 to 12 car lengths. Darrell Waltrip crossing the start-finish line and completing lap number 208. Running in third place continues to be Joe Ruttman. Fourth is Jeff Bodine. Those four cars on the lead lap. In fifth place, a lap down, car number 44, driven by Terry Labonte.
And then come the Petties, Dale Earnhardt and Tim Richmond. Those people we know continue to be on the lead lap, and we believe that both Ronnie Bouchard, who spun very early in this race, and Lake Speed also are just one lap down. They're being showed by scoring in 10th and 11th position. Here goes Walter to the high side of DK again, and now moving up on James Houser.
We are at North Wilkesboro, North Carolina Speedway for the Holly Farms 400 as ESPN presents live this Grand National competition. I'm Bob Jenkins along with Larry Neuber, and Ned Jarrett is covering our pit area activity. The leader of this race, Darrell Waltrip, he has been one of two leaders. The other one, Bobby Allison, but Allison is out of the race with a blown engine.
The first race ever held here at the North Wilkesboro Speedway goes back 33 years ago. October 16th of 1949. It was one of the 8 races held in the first year ever of Grand National Stock Car Racing. Talk about being steeped in tradition. The track was not blacktopped until 1957. The first winner of a pavement race here was Jack Smith. But back in that period between 49 and 57, look and listen to some of the names of people who have won here. As we look at Morgan Shepherd, running in approximately 13th or 14th position now. He's been lapped twice under green flag conditions. In North Wilkesboro earnings, he has won over $7,500. He comes as a short track specialist. A lot of people thought that he might be one of the favorites here.
Morgan Shepherd driving the Levi Garrett Buick started in ninth position, qualifying at 113.208. A little faster than he can roller skate, but he's not bad in that area either.
It's going to be a great trip.
No matter where people go, Conoco helps them get there. Our motor oils protect trucks over the long haul and farm equipment against the worst conditions.
Have a good trip.
A Conoco lubricant even protects the space shuttle. We use the same technology to make super and all-season motor oils for your car. Conoco, hottest brand going.
When football fans and food team up for tailgating time, what's more natural than Natural Light from Anheuser-Busch? The beer with a taste for food that just naturally leaves you room for more. So when you're going for that extra yard,
what's more natural than Natural Light?
Back in North Wilkesboro, North Carolina for the Holly Farms 400, the 25th race on the Grand National Circuit this year as the season winds down, but the points battle continues to be very competitive. Bobby Allison, who is leading the point standings at this time, has already dropped from the race, and the guy who would like to move into the top spot in points, Darrell Waltrip, is leading this race. And the guy who heads the Duke crew, well, it's Junior Johnson, a former driver and a very colorful person along the trail. Ned Jarrett, talk with him.
One of the most successful drivers and car owners in NASCAR is Junior Johnson, who lives within a stone's throw of the 5/8 mile North Wilkesboro Speedway here. He's a member of the National Motorsports Press Association Hall of Fame. He won 50 Grand National races before he hung it up as a driver some 16 years ago. But since then, he's been one of the most potent car owners on the circuit, and particularly here at North Wilkesboro. Junior, what is it? It doesn't matter what driver you put in that car number 11. They always seem to be able to win here.
Well, Ned, if you go back and check, I've had some awful good drivers in it. Kale and Darrell and Bobby and different ones that I've had in it. They've all been exceptional good drivers, so I got to give the driver a lot of credit for it. But this is our hometown. We put a little special effort into it, and I know a whole lot about the racetrack, so I think I have a little advantage from knowing what it takes to run this place.
Well, now, what does it take without giving away any secrets?
Well, it's a racetrack. It has two different kind of turns, and it's got two different kind of straightaways. You got to go uphill, going up the back stretch, and downhill, coming down the front stretch. So your engine combination's got to be a source that it'll take a lot of winding down the front straightaway. And you got to carburate the thing where it's got a lot of torque getting up off the corner to go up the back stretch. So it's a little bit of a unique type racetrack to get an engine to function like it should. Just like here today, we spent the whole entire morning carburetting the thing to go up the backstretch. So that's how particular, the motor has to be to do the right kind of job here.
Well, now, you'd think that you'd need an engineer's degree to figure all of that out, and you'd be the first to admit that you don't have that kind of formal education.
Well, I don't have very much education at all, and I suffer over a period of years for that reason. But I think good common sense sometimes and a lot of trial and error sometimes is as good to you as a lot of education is. So experience and knowledge of what has stuck in the past has been our success, and I've had good drivers.
Now, the fans see you on race day. We'll see you here on the ESPN, of course, during the race with the headset on. What kind of communication do you have with Darrell Waltrip out there? Do you tell him how to drive the race car, or what do you talk about?
Well, basically, he tells me sort of what the cars are doing. Then when we make a pit stop, we got our tires to go over temperature-wise and the air pressure-wise, and all of this stuff gives us the input of what the cars are doing. So I refer back to him what we find here, and he refers to us what he finds on the racetrack. And then the next pit stops when I do the adjusting to compensate whatever's wrong with the car.
You still going to win that Winston Cup championship this year?
Well, Ned, it's going to be a tough road to go. We're going after it. There's no question about that. What we're basically going to try to do the rest of the year is win every race we go to. And if Bobby has bad luck, we'll be in there. But if he has good luck, it's going to be tough.
And if you don't do it this year, you'll be back trying in 1983.
Well, next year we'll try a little different. We won't give him this head start that we've gave him this time.
Well, when he talks about the head start, of course, Bobby Allison won the Daytona 500, jumped off into the Winston Cup point lead, and has been tough to catch ever since.
And ESPN salutes one of the guys who has made NASCAR Grand National Competition what it is today, Junior Johnson. We'll be back with more of our live coverage on ESPN. Darrell Waltrip continues to lead. Harry Gant is second.
Formula One. Indy.
Roberts in the country. He's been running the sixth and eighth here this afternoon. He's been running in the top five, fourth right now, but he's not running quite as strong as he was earlier. We're with Darrell Bryan, the crew chief on the car. Darrell, what is wrong? He's not running quite as fast as he was earlier.
National races are held a year here at North Wilkesboro Speedway. Next year, the first race will be on April 17th. The Northwestern Bank 400, then the Holly Farms 400, scheduled for October 2nd of 1983. Upcoming races for the Grand National Circuit, the Miller High Life 300, October 9th of 1982, the National 500, that's at Charlotte Motor Speedway, the National 500 to be held on October the 10th. It's one of the most prestigious events on the NASCAR Winston Cup circuit. And then the 9th on Saturday, Charlotte will host a 300-mile NASCAR late model sportsman race, offering points in the Mid-Atlantic region of the rich Winston Racing Series, as well as the Budweiser Divisional Championship points. Big weekend at Charlotte Motor Speedway, the 9th and the 10th, the 300 late model sportsman race and the National 500. The 400-lap race here on this 5/8-mile track is now 242 laps into the event. 242 laps in. Darrell Waltrip is the leader. The best race on the track is for ninth position. Dale Earnhardt now holds it, but he's receiving a stiff challenge from Lake Speed in car number 17.
Now, Lake Speed, the former world go-karting champion, runs very competitive here at North Wilkesboro. Some of his finest performances in NASCAR racing, ironically enough, have come at the big track down at Daytona. And Speed gets a nice line underneath Earnhardt and slips through, threading that needle and not giving Dale a whole lot of extra room, but plenty of room. There's a whole lane up there, but Earnhardt leans on the banking as they go into turn number one, now around the what must seem flat corner, uphill, down the backstretch. Watch Earnhardt try and lean on the banking. He goes into three, but he just doesn't have enough momentum, and Lake Speed has just improved itself by one position. Lake Speed, the driver from the Jackson, Mississippi area, who has been running late models back home and doing so with success in between Grand National Stock Car races.
And there is Dale Earnhardt, who has won $56,600 in seven starts here at the North Wilkesboro Racetrack. Dale Earnhardt now in 10th, and in ninth position is Lake Speed, car number 17.
Earnhardt also has won $313,000 this year. That ranks him number four in total dollars won in the 1982 season. The interesting driver on that money won for the 1982 season list to me is, well, actually two of them, Ronnie Bouchard and Jody Ridley. The neither one of them have won a race yet this year, but Bouchard has won over $250,000 and Ridley almost $240,000. They're sixth and seventh. They haven't even had a victory.
Here is the leader, Darrell Waltrip, and the number 11, Mountain Dew Buick. Darrell from Franklin, Tennessee, 35 years of age, has been leading since lap number 141. On lap 140, Bobby Allison blew an engine. Darrell went into the lead and has held it ever since. Still running in second position is Harry Gant in car number 33, but the interval between first and second place is about a full straightaway. We'll check it here. Darrell Walter comes down and crosses the start-finish line, goes into turn number one, and right now, crossing the start-finish line, is the number 33 in Harry Gant. So it's about a full straightaway lead for Darrell Waltrip. Darrell moves to the inside, going into turn number three, and passes Ron Bouchard in car number 47, who is running in the top 10. The interval now we will pick up in time, in terms of time,
about five and a half, I'm going to guess.
Brother. 5.4 seconds, the interval between Darrell Waltrip and second place, Harry Gant. Third place belongs to Joe Rutman, and fourth place is Jeff Lodine. Those cars on the lead lap. Back in fifth position, a lap down, is Terry Labonte, car number 44. There he is.
Well, some good action. Labonte in fifth place, still trying to make up that lap, but it doesn't look like he's going to have much of a chance of doing that. Earnhardt there at number 15 has been lapped twice. He's two laps down, as is Tim Richmond, two laps down. That group of cars has been running very competitively all day. Jody Ridley has been lapped three times, and he is the leader of the contingent of cars that is three laps down. But they have been in heavy traffic most of the afternoon, and Speed, Earnhardt, Richmond, Labonte, and Ridley, gosh, they've been doing a lot of racing. Going at it tooth and nail, banging fenders, which is very much a part of short track racing. And I'll tell you, short track racing, whoever said it's not exciting, they were walking down the wrong alley. It's very exciting. Waltrip right now, by the way, is moving up as we continue to watch Earnhardt to lap Jeff Bodine, and that would mean that we have only three cars then on the lead lap if Waltrip can execute that. We don't figure to be that close to any pit stops with about 250 laps down. Most of these crews are probably planning on going at least another 30 laps if earlier experience in this race is any indication before they stop again.
There's a driver we talked about earlier, D.K. Ulrich in car number 6, the Pentax Cameras Buick. D.K. is 38 years of age. As we indicated, several different drivers have been in this car. Rubber being changed on the right side of it, fuel being put in, and the stop for D.K. Ulrich, 19.7 seconds, and he's back in competition.
Well, D.K. is also one of the drivers who's been involved in the Hollywood projects of 1982 that are related directly to Grand National Stock Car Racing. There are two movies, Six Pack and Stand On It, one of the Hal Needham productions, that are being filmed this summer here in the Southland. And D.K., along with Buddy Arrington, Bobby Wallach, Elmo Langley, and Richard Childress, have been supplying race cars at a cost of $1,000 a day rental for those movies.
Well, the lake speed got a little high going into turns 3 and 4, and because of that, Dale Earnhardt was able to sneak underneath him. Now Tim Richmond moves side by side with Lake Speed down the backstretch, and Lake may be having a problem. He got way high on the racetrack, and three cars have passed him now in the last lap: Earnhardt, Richmond, and Terry Labonte. Here they come down the main straightaway. Dale Earnhardt, car number 15. Dale is eighth in point standings at this time with 2,900. He, of course, is a former Grand National champion.
Well, Speed and Richmond and Earnhardt, they're racing for position. So at least at this point, that little momentary loss of control on behalf of Lake Speed cost him some money. Of course, he's got about 200 laps to make up for it. But they are on the same lap, two laps down to the leader, Waltrip. And they're going at it for position.
Joe Rutman in car number 75 is in third place, and it's his best performance in quite a few races. We go down to Ned Jarrett.
Joe Rutman is taking a distinctively different line as he comes into third one. We see him coming in here now. Here comes a good car length lower than anybody else. In fact, he's down so low that the pavement is banked the other way as he goes in there. And that's why he's working well for that car number 75. And I'll tell you one thing. We're standing down here and he really has his hands full when he comes in there. But he's had a lot of experience on a track like this, so he knows what's going on.
Well, you're absolutely right. He is so low on the racetrack down at one that he actually is running on the apron where the banking goes the other direction. But it's working well for Joe Rutman, who is in third place, blasting out of the pit area. for 98, Morgan Shepherd, the Lehigh Garrett Buick. So we have seen a couple of pit stops here in the last few laps, and in a few more laps, begin to see the leaders come in, I'm sure. Off of turn number four, completing lap number 261, is Darrell Waltrip.
Well, Joe Ruttman is the guy we commented earlier, originally lived in the Detroit area. Of course, he's the older brother, maybe that's the younger brother of the winner of the 1952 Indianapolis 500. There's Joe sliding out of turn number four. Now, watch the slow line Ned Jarrett was talking about. He hit the white line going into turn number one. We don't see anybody else going down there. You see the other cars a good 2 or 3 feet above that white line. That's to give that line of demarcation to the driver so that they know that where the banking stops and the level part of the racetrack begins.
And we are seeing several drivers down in turns one and two way up high on the banking. So it's a racetrack that the drivers can run several different grooves on. Right now, Darrell Waltrip is leader of the Holly Farms 400 at North Wilkesboro. Stalling down in turn number one, and that has caused a flurry of pit stop activity. The leader, Darrell Waltrip, is in for a change of all four tires. He blasts out of the pit area. Ahead of him, Harry Gant is also in for a stop. So is Jeff Bodine in car number 50. Morgan Shepherd also in for a stop. 23.8 seconds was the stop for Darrell Waltrip, but very importantly, he changed all four tires.
Yeah, so did the Skull Bandit crew with Harry Gant at the control. They changed all four tires and got out at almost exactly the same time. They fitted together. They pulled out together. Jeff Bodine was directly in front of him. Remember, Jeff was just left about 6 or 7 laps to go, and that crew, I'm sure, had hopes of getting out in front of Waltrip, which would have allowed Jeff to go all the way around the track with the pace car on the racetrack, picking up the leader, and possibly make up the lap that he lost under green flag. But it didn't happen that way. Bodine gets back out onto the racetrack, and he still is a lap down. He's only 3 cars behind Waltrip, and if the unpredictable occurs, as we look at King Richard in the pits, and Bodine has got a great setup and gets around Waltrip, he's got a shot at getting on the lead lap.
Richard Petty still in the pits. Again, all four tires being changed on that car. Now he moves away. Joe Ruttman was also in. Tim Richmond, who caused this caution period, has now made it around the track and into his pit area again. And I really can't speculate on what happened to Tim. He had just come in for a pit stop and did not make it to turn number two. Here is Joe Ruttman in car number 75 in for his stop. Joe has been leading or led 2 laps just a second ago, laps 269 and 270, while Waltrip and Gant came in for their pit stop. So Joe Ruttman is one of 3 leaders that we have had in this race today. And Ned Jarrett is doing a fine job of covering the pit area for us today. Here he is.
This is one of the tires that they just took off of Darrell Waltrip's car. This was the right front, and the tire wear is very good here this afternoon, Bob. One of the Goodyear engineers came over and measured the tread depth after the tire came off, and it has 4/32 of rubber on the outside, 3 3/4 on the inside. So that means that that inside of that tire is really working well going into the turns. That's the way that they want it. And with only about 6/32 of rubber on this tire when it was brand new, that is exceptionally good tire wear. So they got no problem from the tire standpoint here this afternoon.
One thing, it isn't excessively hot here today, and there has been a cloud cover, and this haze also continuing, so that could be leading to the fact that tire wear is not real great today.
Well, that and the fact that Junior Johnson is relatively skilled at setting up a race car contributes to pretty predictable tire wear, I would suspect.
Yellow continues to be displayed. The pace car is leading them through turns 3 and 4. The cars have lined up, and they're 2 abreast formation. But the pace car is going to stay out for at least 1 more lap. 3 cars now on the lead lap as Darrell Waltrip and Harry Gant and Joe Ruttman are in the outside lane. And the 4th place car of Jeff Bodine, car number 50, is the first behind the pace car on the inside.
Well, in the 2 abreast start, of course, Jeff Bodine, as being one of the lap cars, has an interesting opportunity. He pulls right up alongside of Waltrip, and if he can out-drag race him into turn number one, Bodine might get that lap back.
We have several auto races coming up for you on ESPN, and we also have NBA activity as the Detroit Pistons will be taking on the Indiana Pacers at 7:30 p.m. Eastern Time, 4:30 Pacific Time on Sunday, October 31st, and then at 10 o'clock Eastern Time, 7 p.m. Pacific Time, it's the Phoenix Suns against the Denver Nuggets. NBA activity all year long for you on ESPN, including the playoffs. The pace car has pulled off of the racetrack, and the green is back out. Jeff Bodine, car number 50, who started from that inside position, has now moved ahead of Darrell Waltrip, and then he is going to attempt to get back on the same lap. Bob, I think they're going to black flag Jeff Bodine. Jeff Bodine started to accelerate before the caution flag, and Jeff is going to be in a worse situation now than he was when he was a lap behind. The black flag coming out for Bodine as he passed the leader, Darrell Waltrip, before the green flag fell.
You are absolutely right. Harold Kinder, the official starter for the Grand National Circuit, has black flagged Jeff Bodine, and that means he must come in for consultation. Jeff pulling to the inside of the racetrack, and he will make the stop right now. Meanwhile, the leaders, Darrell Waltrip and Harry Gant, swing high past him and continue on in the racetrack. There is Jeff Bodine screeching to a halt. All he has to do is stop, and now he goes again. Black flag because he jumped the start when we went back green.
Well, Jeff does not lose a position. He is back out on the racetrack already. There he is going down the backstretch. He's at the very tail end of the field. He's still one lap down, and now I stand corrected as I think back. Yes, he will have lost some positions because the other cars on the track now who are also just one lap down, namely Labonte and Richard Petty, are on the racetrack ahead of him, so it did cost Jeff some positions.
Here is Darrell Waltrip completing lap number 277. We have 123 laps to go. Darrell Waltrip has pretty much dominated this race, at least since Bobby Allison dropped out of the competition with a blown engine. That occurred on lap number 140. Harry Gant, the only serious challenge that Darrell has had to deal with in the last few laps. And although Harry is several car lengths behind, he still is in pretty good position.
A little while ago, we were talking about the history of this racetrack as we continue to watch Darrell Waltrip get around the North Wilkesboro Speedway. We wanted to make mention of some of the winners on dirt here at the North Wilkesboro Speedway. There's a pack of cars really going at it. Joe Ruttman heading it up, the man who's in third place. Bouchard has done a pretty good job since that early race spin. All three flocks have won here at North Wilkesboro. Bob in 49, Fondi in 51, and Tim in 56. Churchill McGriff in 1954. Dick Rafton won the other race in 54. And of course, the legendary Speedy Thompson and Herb Thomas, both in the fabulous Hudson Hornets, have all won races here at North Wilkesboro when it was dirt back in the 40s and the 50s.
In this group of cars that we're following, Ron Bouchard in 47, Joe Ruttman in car number 75, a few car lengths behind Joe Ruttman is Dale Earnhardt, then Mark Martin, Kyle Petty, Morgan Shepherd, and Lake Speed. Well, we just completed a series of pit stops during which a lot of fuel was put in and during which a lot of tires were changed. Along with that, ESPN and a track back.
If you've ever jacked a car up along the highway, you know that the wheels have a tendency to sag and droop, and it makes it awkward to remove the tire if you have to change a tire. Well, in Grand National competition, all the cars run this chain that is affixed to the rear trailing arm, and what it does, it prevents the wheel and the axle from slowing down, making it difficult to change in, say, 15 seconds in a very quickly needed pit stop.
Just a little more than 100 laps to go at North Wilkesboro. Darrell Waltrip, the leader. Harry Gant, second. Joe Ruttman is third. Terry Labonte is running in fourth position. We'll be back for more of this race after these messages.
And I feel you better kiss me than jump back. And when I win that championship, get the picture in view. I'm going to join that West Side Country Club.
If you'd like to give a special gift to a boy or girl 8 years old and up, get your pencil ready and write down this address, because I've got just the answer for you. It's National Geographic World Magazine, published especially for kids by the National Geographic Society, the same people who produced world-famous National Geographic Magazine. It brings real-life adventure, page after page of fascinating articles and pictures in National Geographic color on animals, outdoor adventure and science, sports, hobbies and crafts. Yet, while it entertains, it fulfills curiosity, stimulates imagination, and encourages your youngsters to read more. It's amazingly inexpensive, only $8.95 for 12 monthly issues in brilliant geographic color. No fuss, no shopping, no wrapping, no shipping. Compare this once-a-month, 12-times-a-year gift to a single gift from a toy shop, and you can see what a bargain this is. You cannot get it at the newsstand or a bookstore. You can only get it through the mail, and it's so easy to order. Just send your young person's name and address along with $8.95 to National Geographic World, Box 121, Plainville, Connecticut. Each issue has exciting surprises, puzzles to solve, games they can play with their friends, mazes to work out, punch-outs to put together, and 4 times a year, super-sized pull-outs to put on the wall. What a marvelous gift for any young person. It pleases while it teaches. And when you send your subscription order today, we'll also mail a special personalized gift card from you. So send $8.95 along with your young person's address and your name for the gift card to National Geographic World, Box 121, Plainville, Connecticut, 06062. 12 colorful issues with exciting games and puzzles, big super-sized pullouts, and a card from you. This gift lasts a year. The benefits may last a lifetime.
This ESPN Sports Center update is brought to you by GMC. Trucks are what we're all about.
Hi again, everybody. Dave Sanders with this ESPN Sports Center update. We'll return to our coverage of the Holly Farms 400 Grand National Stock Car Race in just a moment. But first, let's get caught up on the baseball playoffs. American League activity in progress. Milwaukee taking on California for the second night in a row in Anaheim, and the Angels are leading that one 4-2 in the seventh. Milwaukee batting in the top of the seventh, Pete Vukovich against Bruce Kieson. Reggie Jackson has a solo homer for California. Paul Molitor, a two-run inside the park variety for the Brewers. California leading 4-2 in the seventh. The Angels won last night's opener. Tomorrow, a travel day, and then the series will continue in Milwaukee on Friday and Saturday and Sunday if those games are necessary. Right now, California trying to take a two-game advantage in that best-of-five game set. Meanwhile, in the National League, Atlanta and St. Louis were supposed to get things started today. They had a rain delay in the fifth inning with one out and Atlanta leading 1-0, but the rain continued. They had to postpone the affair, so it will be rescheduled, and everything will go back to scratch. They'll start it all tomorrow night. So the opener, Atlanta and St. Louis, now in the National League, will begin tomorrow night. Pascual Perez will pitch for Atlanta, and Bob Forsch on the mound for the Cardinals. Phil Niekro and Joaquin Andujar had started today. We're going to get caught up on activity in the National Hockey League after we hear this word from GMC.
Diesel news from GMC Truck. The 6.2-liter truck diesels available in hard-working GMC pickups. The diesel-powered four-wheel drive Jimny. And GMC Suburbans with plenty of tow power. And now GMC offers the 6.2 diesel in its vans. Versatile trucks that are very economical. See all these fuel-saving diesel-powered trucks at your GMC dealer. At GMC, trucks are what we're all about.
Lots of activity in the National Hockey League. Let's go to the board. Quebec leading Buffalo 6-4 in the third. Peter Stastny with a hat trick for the Nordiques. 2-1 St. Louis over Detroit, third period. Washington has just defeated the Rangers 5-4. That is a final. Montreal hosting Hartford. Canadiens lead 2-1 in the second. Chicago leading Toronto 1-0. Blackhawks with the advantage at the end of one. Minnesota playing at Winnipeg, who leads 1-0 in the second. Later tonight, Vancouver will take on Los Angeles. That gets you caught up on scores at this hour. I'm Dave Sanders, ESPN.
North Wilkesboro, Buddy Arrington in car number 67, the only Dodge in today's race, is calling it quits, and this is quite a story. He has been in all 24 races this year and has completed 23 of the 24.
Absolutely incredible. His high water mark in the point standings was as high as fourth earlier in the year. He's been fourth, fifth, and sixth most of the season, but that's astounding. I don't think they've absolutely thrown in the towel completely yet. The crew is still working on the cars, but he would certainly like to get back out again.
Our most recent caution period brought about by a stalled car down in turn number two. And Ned Jarrett has moved down to the Tim Richmond pit to find out exactly what happened.
Well, Tim Richmond brought out the last caution flag when the car stalled going into turn one after he made a pit stop. Tim, what went wrong?
Well, leaving the pits, the rear end went out of the car. We either chipped the tooth off it or something, and it stripped all the gears, and it quit running or quit seeing the gear, I guess you could say. Leaving the pit, and I didn't want to bring out the caution, so we brought it up out of the way, but they threw the caution anyway.
Tim, how are the track conditions out there now?
Well, once in a while, they were getting a little oily, a little slick down below, and you'd move up a little bit, they were just as slick, and you'd wait a few laps, and you can move back down, but they're not the best. The track's starting to chunk up or go away up in 3 and 4. And they put some something what we call bear grease on there. And it's starting to peel off or roll off the track and it's giving everybody a bit.
Bob, here's a fellow that has a bright future in auto racing. He won the Budweiser 400 earlier this year in Riverside, California. He won one of the Bush Bowls already this year. And is counting to be one of the superstars of the future.
Well, we look for Tim to be a superstar in the Indianapolis type car competition. He won the Rookie of the Year honor at the Indy 500, but soon after that decided to give up the Indy cars for the Grand National Circuit and has already won one race this year on the Winston Cup Circuit.
Also picked up one of the few small speaking parts among the racing fraternity. Some of the movies, or one of the two movies at least, is being produced this summer. Tim Richmond, without a doubt, a name that portends something for the future, and he's one of those guys who just seems to have all sorts of talent, and you just wonder what direction he'll choose to go, because it's almost inevitable that he'll be a success.
Well, Ned has moved from the one end of the pit area down to the other. He is now with Buddy Arrington, who is also out of the race.
Buddy, what went wrong with tonight?
Well, we switched to Bowen Gears before the race. Decided to go ahead and get a Bowen Gears for Wilkesboro race. We've been running the Chrysler stuff, and
Virginia, 44 years of age, started 19th in the race today, qualifying at 110.467 miles an hour.
And the sponsors of the week for Buddy, Shockey Motors in Harrisburg, Virginia, and the Reed Trailer people.
Here is the leader of the Holly Farms 400, Darrell Waltrip, in car number 11. Darrell takes the car into turn number two, now brings it high off of turn two down the backstretch. The second place driver is Harry Ginn from Taylorsville, North Carolina. And we will get the interval between first and second place now. Waltrip crosses the start-finish line. We look for Harry Ginn coming out of turn number four. Here he is. And it's still about a five-second lead for Darrell Waltrip.
And apparently there's something about autumn that seems to go well with Mountain Dew. If things go better with Coke, autumn goes better with Mountain Dew. Because it was this point in the season a year ago that Junior Johnson, Darrell Waltrip and company really began to come on strong in Grand National Stock Car Racing. In the last 14 races, the time interval between first and second, still about 5.5 seconds. In the last 14 races in 1981, yes, the last 14 races, almost half of the season, all of their finishes were in the top six, repeat all. He won seven times. In the last six races alone, the time of the year we're into right now, he won four times. Here we are in the 1982 season, and again, Waltrip coming on strong late in the year.
We'll run down the top five for you. Waltrip the leader, Harry Ginn second. Third place still belongs to Joe Ruttman, those three cars on the lead lap. One lap down in fourth place is Terry Labonte, and a lap down in fifth position is Richard Petty. And we have completed 300. 106 laps. We've got 94 to go now. Darrell Waltrip appears well on his way to victory. And ahead of him right now is Mark Martin, who is still out there in competition. We'll talk more about Mark and some of the other drivers still in the race in just a moment.
What's more natural than
82 covering live for you today, the Winston Cup 400 lap race from North Wilkesboro, North Carolina Speedway. The leader, Darrell Waltrip, in the number 11 Mountain Dew Buick. Harry Gant in the Skoal Bandit Buick is running in second position. Third place belongs to Joe Ruttman in car number 75. A good job of driving by Joe Ruttman. That is the Raymock racing car, and Butch Mock is with Ned Jarrett.
His name is what helps to make up part of the Raymock name. Butch, it still doesn't seem to be running quite as well now as it was earlier.
Well, we just changed tires in that last caution, and the chassis are real loose now. We should be able to go the rest of the race on the tires, but if not, we'll have to just ride it out like it is.
Don't think we've got much of a chance to catch you closer to home.
No, he's running awful good today.
Well, all three of those cars up front are running awfully good. In fact, this is one of Rutland's better runs, or at least let's say that he stayed in longer than he has been in a lot of the races earlier this year.
From Upland, California, in the Penn Derek Buick, running in third place, as Larry indicated. He has already said that he will not drive that car next year. The car's out of the race. J.D. McDuffie, Dean Combs, Jimmy Walker, Ronnie Thomas, and Ricky Rudd also dropping out. Buddy Baker, Joel Stowe, Bobby Allison, Buddy Arrington, and Tim Richmond. But there are a lot of cars still out there in competition. Some of those that we haven't talked too much about include Mark Martin, the number 02, James Hilton, car number 48, and also still out there in competition, Dave Marcus, car number 71.
And there were three drivers who came to North Wilkesboro this weekend who were not fortunate enough to qualify for the field. Ed Bogus, a driver whom we had not seen at a Grand National track before. Rick Newsom, who has the Bojangles sponsorship, another one of those outgrowths of the movie activity of this year. And Eddie Falk from Norfolk, Virginia, also entered here. He crashed but was uninjured on the backstretch here at North Wilkesboro this weekend.
Mark Martin from North Liberty, Indiana, is still out there in competition as we continue to watch our leader, Darrell Waltrip, in car number 11. There is Mark in car number 02. Mark is 17th in the point standings this year. Has not had all that great a season. He has won $93,395 on the Winston Cup Trail, has accumulated 2,383 points, and has driven in all 25 races to this point. But Mark Martin not doing as well in the Winston Cup Series as he did in American Speed Association competition. He was a three-time champion. And the car looked a little loose there in turn number two. The back end got around on him.
More than just a little bit of smoke coming from the right rear tire as he was battling with Terry Labonte on the racetrack. Mark has been the subject of a very interesting revelation for the 1982 season. Faye Darnell from the north and Bobby Jones from the south are going together in the Darnell Jones Company, and they will debut their brand new car at Charlotte next week. There is Jackie Martin, Mark's mother, who is a permanent member of the team. She's also the business manager of the Mark Martin Racing Team. But they will, Mark will debut the new Darnell Jones race car October 9th at Charlotte, just next week.
As we indicated, Mark Martin won many, many races in ASA competition. He came here to Winston Cup Racing for the first time full-time this year, but hasn't tasted
victory. It's a little bit tough. It's hard to get used to. But, you know, I didn't win my first year in ASA either, so that's the thing that keeps me going is I remember that I was thrilled to death to finish in the top 10, you know, if we'd go to an ASA race, I'd be thrilled to death if we had a top 10 finish, and that's kind of how it is now, and it was fun for me to make the improvements and become more and more competitive in ASA, and I think I'm going to, you know, I think this is going to be even a bigger reward for me.
Well, he drove in a few races last year, but this is his first full season, and he is in the battle for Rookie of the Year in Winston Cup Racing. We will be back with more action from North Wilkesboro, North Carolina in a moment.
What's new in cars? One that's as easy to drive as a tricycle, and as easy on gas as a motorcycle. America's three-wheeled idea car.
Talking about Mark Martin being in the battle for Rookie of the Year honors, he is in second place in the point standings. Jeff Bodine is the leader with 217 points. Brad Teague is third with 107, and Jim Sauter fourth with 46 points. Now, the Rookie of the Year is not determined by the points. It is rather voted on at the end of the year, but the points certainly play a part in the voting that's done, Larry.
They play a major role, Bob, and like a year ago, it's going to be a tough, tough decision again. Martin had that big lead early in the season. A lot of folks thought that Rusty Wallace was going to mount a full season run for Rookie of the Year honors in Grand National Racing, but that didn't happen. Bodine landed the ride in the then-called Performance Connection race car about, a third of the way into the season, and has really come on very strong. The car now has had a sponsor change. The man who owns the race car has several businesses that he is involved with. And to that end, Cliff Stewart has put the name of Spectrum Furniture on the side of the Pontiac. But it is still the same team, and Bodine has been very successful with it.
Here's the leader, Darrell Waltrip, in the Mountain Dew Buick. Darrell leading since lap number 140. The speed of the race at this point is 96.058 miles an hour. We have been under four caution periods, one for a blown engine on the J.D. McDuffie car. Dale Earnhardt brought out the yellow for a spin. Then Bobby Allison's engine let go, bringing out a yellow, and the number two car of Tim Richmond stalled down in turn number one to bring out the most recent caution period. And here is a story. Darrell Waltrip on the outside in turn number four, or rather turn number two, passes the third place car. And so now only two cars are on the lead lap, Darrell Waltrip and Harry Gant.
And Waltrip continues also to put distance between himself and Harry. Darrell, as you see, entering turn three right now. Harry entering turn number two. So it's not quite a half a lap lead, but it certainly is a substantial lead as Waltrip is just orbiting around this racetrack with the consistency of a planet around our sun, and nobody is getting anywhere near Darrell Waltrip today or Solwood team. Could win number 10 be on the horizon? Well, we're coming down to the latter stages of the race. We have well under 100 laps to go, about 75 to be exact, and Darrell Waltrip certainly has been the main man here today, but that's nothing new. Over the past 5 years, this guy has been the dominant driver in Grand National Racing. Waltrip is the leader of wins in the last 5 years of this type of racing. He has won 45 times as we tune in on Dale Earnhardt, who is not among the top five in winners over the last 5 years. Cale Yarborough, ironically enough, is second with 34 wins. Make that Yarborough is now third. Bobby Allison has moved into second. But Cale and Bobby also in the top five, most wins in the last 5 years.
Dale Earnhardt off of turn number four, approaching the number 24, driven by Cecil Gordon. They go into turn number one. Cecil Gordon is driving the Western Carolina forklift Buick. Cecil hails from Downhill, Virginia, is 41 years of age, and is among several cars still out there in competition.
Now, Cecil, in talking with him earlier this weekend here at North Wilkesboro, who has prided himself in the past few seasons of fielding a car for every race on the Grand National Circuit, admits that he doesn't think he's going to be able to do it in 1983. They're already in a position where they're selecting 15 or 16 races that they will be competing at next year. And they're kind of in the market for a driver. They would like a driver who perhaps is already funded with a sponsor to come along and hook up with them for the 1983 season. Here's a man who back in 71 and 1974 was third in the point standing when he was able to run the whole season. He's had quite a number of drivers since that time. Morgan Shepherd drove this car for a while last year, right after Morgan lost his driving performance connection car.
Darrell Waltrip approaching Dale Earnhardt here down at turn number one. We'll give you the top ten. Waltrip is the leader, Gant second. Joe Ruttman is third. Terry Labonte is fourth. Richard Petty running in fifth place. Jeff Bodine is sixth. Seventh is Ron Bouchard. Eighth position belongs to Dale Earnhardt. And ninth is Lake Speed. Tenth place is the number 71 of Dave Marcus. Then in 11th is Jody Ridley. And 12th is Kyle Petty. Only two cars now on the lead lap, Waltrip and Harry Gant.
The North Wilkesboro area nestled among the brushy mountains that we have shown you several times today. It really is one of the more interesting areas, not only in the Grand National Trail, but maybe even in our country. It's one of the main centers of the furniture building industry in America. We're just off the Blue Ridge Parkway, which a lot of people will tell you is one of the most scenic of all the roads running across America. It's also the area of some famous people. One of our broadcasting colleagues, Howard Cosell, from nearby Winston-Salem. A couple of famous athletes, Bob McAdoo, Don Scholander, of course, of swimming fame, and more recently, David Thompson and Tom Bertelson, who play in the NBA, are also from this area. Tom Bertelson, a high school All-American for Avery County High School in nearby Avery County.
And Dave Marcus, the driver of car number 71, right behind this guy, Morgan Shepherd. Dave is from Avery's Creek, North Carolina, and Dave is driving the Hudson Chevrolet here today. He used to hail from Wausau, Wisconsin, has moved closer to the hub of NASCAR racing. Shepherd is in 12th position, and Dave Marcus running 13th at this point.
And the sponsor of the week for Dave Marcus, another one of those guys, very successful as he travels around the country and follows the Grand National Tour, picking up a particular sponsor, sometimes for 1 week, sometimes for 3 or 4 weeks. One of this week, 2 months. Yamaha Company from up in Pennsylvania.
Morgan Shepherd, car number 98, the lead by Garrett Buick. Morgan, one of the regular competitors on the Grand National Circuit. Well, Darrell Waltrip continues to lead, and the fans continue to wait and see whether he'll be able to pull off the victory this afternoon.
Michelob brings you the 7-day weekend. Boy meets girl style. Meeting over a Michelob can show that special someone just how special you are. So don't just make a date for the weekend. Set the mood anytime with a smooth and mellow taste of Michelob.
I knew she couldn't refuse an invitation like this.
Put a little weekend in your week.
Yeah.
Wherever your travels take you, enjoy the protection of Xerex.
Xerex.
A premium antifreeze that protects against boilovers in the heat of summer.
Xerex.
Protects against freeze-ups during the coldest winter months and year-round against rust and corrosion, even on aluminum parts.
Xerex.
Wherever your travels take you, enjoy premium protection that lasts. Xerex.
If our cars break down during a race, chances are we're finished for the day. But it doesn't have to be like that if your truck breaks down delivering your goods.
That's right, because you can call Saunders Leasing and rent a replacement rig by the day, week, or month, whenever you need one.
Saunders has a reputation for some of the cleanest, most dependable rental trucks in the country.
So when you have an unexpected breakdown, give Saunders a call.
Rent or lease from Saunders. Check your Yellow Pages or call toll free.
Bob Jenkins, Larry Newber, and Ned Jarrett at North Wilkesboro, North Carolina, with 349 laps completed. Darrell Waltrip is the leader. He has made it look very easy in this race. He's made it look easy this year on the trail, and we ask him why.
Well, I don't know. I'd like to think I could do that everywhere, but we work really hard here for this race. We've been here once before a couple weeks ago testing, and Junior puts a little extra effort into this race, and I guess I do too, really, when you get right down to it. And it's the type of racetrack I enjoy running on. I like a half mile that's got a lot of room to pass on, and this track does. It's got two or three good grooves. You can go high, you can go low, and it's just a great race for a short track, and I enjoy running here, and I think that helps us a lot.
Darrell Waltrip talking about this 5/8-mile racetrack here in North Wilkesboro, North Carolina. That he has pretty much dominated today. He brings the car out of turn number 4, crosses the start-finish line once again, and now completes 353 laps, 47 to go, and Darrell, it looks like, is well on his way to victory, Larry.
Well, his car owner, Junior Johnston, won this race one time as a driver this race, and 5 more times since as a car owner. So to call this place the home track, not only because of the close proximity to where the Junior Johnston garage is just part of the story, it's also the success that this man who was recently initiated, Junior Johnston, into the North Carolina Sports Hall of Fame. There are only 2 other racing personalities who are in the North Carolina Sports Hall of Fame. 2 of the more prominent residents of Randleman, North Carolina, Lee and Richard Petty.
Well, how are things shaping up for the Duke crew? Here is Ned Jarrett to talk with Junior Johnston.
Well, here's the man of the hour in the fifth, the lead to Junior.
remember, Junior. It looked like that was it. You've been going super well out there.
Well, right now, Dad, we look like we're in pretty good shape, but, you know, the race is never won until checkered flag falls, so we're not, you know, in this race, we got to been caught by this thing. We just got to wait and see.
Can you go the rest of the distance?
Another pit stop before this race ends with just a little more than 40 laps to go, and at least Darrell Waltrip isn't going to have to.
Well, theoretically, again, 100 miles per load of fuel, so that would mean maybe a maximum of 2 stops in a race like this. I don't know, what is 400 laps and 5/8 of a mile? If I'd done really good in high school math, I could probably help you out, but basically, if this were a half-mile track, obviously, I can handle that one. That would have been a 200-mile race, meaning 2 loads of fuel. We're a little longer than 200 miles in this event, so for the total of the event, that would indicate that certainly 2 stops would have been more than enough in terms of fuel. But again, tires become such an important factor in this particular race.
Jody Ridley is the driver of car number 90, the Stacy Ford. Jody hails from Chatsworth, Georgia. There he is, running alongside Lake Speed. Jody is 40 years of age. He has 5 top 10 finishes this season.
And his car owner also, Junie Dunleavy, one of the old line of NASCAR racing, along with Junior Johnson, Bud Moore, the Petties, and Elmo Langley and Jabe Thomas, as Buddy Harrington pulls out of the pit and heads back. Talk about one of the old liners in NASCAR racing. Junie Dunleavy, the crew chief and man who puts together this racing team for Jody Ridley, certainly one of the prominent personalities of this sport. Ridley has been a real consistent runner all year long, although he hasn't been close to victory.
As we indicated, Buddy Harrington is back out there on the racetrack. We saw him pull out of the pits just a couple of laps ago. He told us earlier that he was having problems with that car, but apparently they have gotten it fixed, and Buddy Harrington is back out there in competition.
Well, Buddy's trying to make it 24 out of 25, several laps. No, a ton of laps in her rear. But Buddy certainly gets the award for perseverance. He's back out of the speedway.
The number 52 car driven by Jimmy Means, as we continue to go through the field and pick up some of those who are still out there in competition. He has won $18,000 in 12 starts here in North Wilkesboro, North Carolina. Jimmy Means, hailing from Forest City, North Carolina, driving the Broadway Motors Pontiac. Jimmy's 32 years of age.
And he was his crew was the crew that came out with the Boo Crew t-shirts about a month ago, picking up on the success of the Boo Crew campaign. Jimmy is a tall, lanky gentleman who is another one of those independents who enters every one of the races on the Grand National Trail. He has a nickname that a lot of people use called Mutt Beans. That came from the days, he says, when he used to work with Smokey Unique, when he wasn't really a complete Smokey, he was just a little smut, at least according to Jim.
Well, members of the Duke crew seem rather relaxed. A few of them are working their stopwatches. Junior Johnson is looking on, keeping in radio contact with Darrell Waltrip out there. But right now, it is looking good for Darrell. He still has about a 5.5 or 6 second lead on second place. Harry Gant will return at North Wilkesboro after these messages.
Formula One, Indy, NASCAR, Can-Am. Nobody covers the world of racing like Auto Week. Auto Week tells you what really happened on the track and behind the...
Come into the pits, the hood up on the car. Dale has already gotten out of the vehicle, and he is with Ned Jarrett.
Dale is out of the car now, sitting back relaxing. Dale, what went wrong?
Well, he's running along there. First of the race there, Kyle Petty. Hung me and spun me down the back stretch.
brake problem because Dale got up very close to the outside wall in turn number two a couple of laps ago. And then when he came into the pit area, members of his crew were running alongside the car in an attempt to slow it down. They finally did get it stopped, and Dale Earnhardt climbed out.
Well, apparently there's a problem developing with the racetrack up in 3 and 4. It's a race that turn there, that the high-speed turn should normally be the high-speed turn on the racetrack. We see a lot of drivers coming out of turn number 4, almost losing control. Jody Ridley and Kyle Petty again, two of the most recent, really wrestling with the car coming out of turn 4, headed for the front stretch.
The Palatine Auto Parts Chevy being driven this weekend by James Hilton. It's number 48. There he is in the back stretch. James from Inman, South Carolina, veteran, 5 career Winston Cup wins. He's 47 years old. He doesn't compete regularly with the NASCAR circuit, but is still out there in competition here at the Colley Farms 400.
He may well be one of the best race fans among the racing drivers. 3 times he was runner-up in Winston Cup points. There were those seasons when James was able to go after the championship. James recently told us that when he's not involved in driving a race car or fielding the team, that he still loves to even go and watch, that he could probably be at a racetrack every night of the week and every afternoon of the week and never really get bored of it. The former Rex White crew chief, Gene Shelton, who's been involved with many, many competitors on the Grand National Trail through his years.
Average speed of the race, 97.414 miles an hour, and we have completed now 384 laps. We have less than 20 to go, and Darrell Waltrip, the leader, and he has been running flawlessly out there since lap 140. Well, the only other driver on the racetrack that we have not talked about very much is Tommy Gale, the driver of car number 64, the Sonny King Four. Tommy from Elizabeth, Pennsylvania, started 26th here this afternoon, qualifying at 108.203.
We're showing Tommy right now in 17th position as Ronnie Bouchard goes by on the high side. Tommy Gale, who finished 7th in the 1979 Talladega 500, one of his finest finishes in his personal career of being a Grand National driver. He's a trucker from the Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania area. He flies down to the Southland every week to drive this car for Elmo Langley, another one of those old line people who's been around and really made Grand National stock car racing what it is. Tommy Gale, also one of the more personal people and one of the most friendly interviews you'll find anywhere.
Darrell Waltrip from Tennessee leading this race here with just a few more laps to go. Now, National Association of Stock Car Racing and ESPN for the track back.
Ever try to hear something as subtle as a heartbeat when there are 3,600 horsepower engines rumbling around behind you, even if they are just on the caution flag? Well, if you're on the medical squad at a Grand National race, the solution is to take your stethoscope and modify it so that the sound feeds through a shooter's headset. These muffs keep out the outside noise. It may save a life.
Still a lot of noise on the racetrack as a lot of drivers are still chasing Darrell Waltrip. Here he is, the only other one on the lead lap.
You know, this little baby has saved me plenty of time and money, and it's made my life a lot easier, too. So I keep my chainsaw in real good shape. Problem is, all the good care in the world can't keep the saw blade from getting dull. Come, let me show you what I use.
It's the professional tool for homeowners like me, the Miracle Chainsaw Sharpener, and it's worth its weight in gold. The Miracle Chainsaw Sharpener is really easy to use. It locks securely onto the blade of your chainsaw. Once attached, simply put one of the grinding wheels that come in the kit into any drill, even high-speed drills, and you're ready to go. Features like positive alignment assure the correct blade angle and proper guide height. And positive indexing guarantees that each and every sawtooth is honed to a razor-sharp edge. Miracle Chainsaw Sharpener is constructed of heavy-duty metal and will work right along with your chainsaw for years to come. The Miracle Chainsaw Sharpener Kit comes complete with 2 grinding wheels and is only $14.95 plus $2 shipping and handling. You know, if you've ever had your chainsaw sharpened by a professional, you can see what a bargain this is. Because in only three or four usings, the sharpener pays for itself. You know, since fuel costs have skyrocketed, I always keep a good supply of wood around the house. So my miracle sharpener and my chainsaw are more important to me than ever. Now, here's your announcer to tell you how to order.
To order your miracle chainsaw sharpener by credit card, call toll-free 1-800-544-1000. That's 1-800-544-1000. Or send $14.95 plus $2 shipping and handling to Miracle Sharpener, P.O. Box 121, Plainville, Connecticut, 06062. That's Miracle Sharpener, P.O. Box 121, Plainville, Connecticut, 06062. Or call 1-800-544-1000.
The final stages of the Holly Farms 400 unfolding here. The question is, can Darrell Waltrip continue in the lead and win his 10th race this year? 7 laps to go. Darrell has led 327 out of the 400.
And if he continues with the pace he's now setting, goes on to win this. He's already led more laps than any driver could possibly lead here today. He will be going into next weekend's race in Charlotte just 15 points behind, still, but behind Bobby Allison. 15 points deficit going into Charlotte should Waltrip go on to victory here.
And ESPN has a couple of more NASCAR races that we'll do live for you this year. We'll be in Rockingham, North Carolina for a 500-mile race on that super speedway. And then we will conclude our NASCAR season at Atlanta International Raceway. The NASCAR season itself concludes at Riverside, California in November.
So Waltrip has called this period of the year like the World Series, the final 7 games of the year, if you will. Last week at Martinsburg, when the Grand National cars were supposed to compete, the race was rained out. Going back the week before that at Dover, when Waltrip won, he said, "I've won game number 1 of the 7 game series." And it looks like right now he is getting ready to chalk up game number 2 of the 7 game series to finish the 1982 season.
Darrell Waltrip in turn number 1. As Harold Kinder, the official starter for the NASCAR Grand National Circuit, readies the white flag. Darrell puts the car now into turn number 3. Cecil Gordon in car number 24 right ahead of him. Here comes Darrell off of the fourth turn, and the white flag is being displayed. One more lap to go. Darrell Waltrip is less than 5/8 of a mile from victory. Waltrip now out of turn number 2 down the backstretch. Waltrip now into turn number 3 is going to be able to coast to victory from this point, and for the 10th time this year, Darrell Waltrip wins a Grand National race. He sticks his left hand outside of the car and salutes as he comes down the straightaway. Second place is going to go to Harry Gann in car number 33. Here he is in the middle of turns 3 and 4. Off of the fourth turn, Harry Gann finishes second. There is the checkered flag to Harry. And the third place driver is going to be Terry Labonte in car number 44. And for Terry, that is his first finish in a top 5 since the Bristol race earlier this year, the Busch 500. We'll be back to interview the winner, Darrell Waltrip. Ned Jarrett will be in victory lane with him when we come back.
Buds for all the guys who keep the action from getting out of hand.
This Bud's for you. For all you do, the king of beers is coming through.
Yeah, just for you. That distinctively clean, crisp taste that says Budweiser.
For all you do.
This Bud's for you.
Activision presents Mega Mania, a new video game for your Atari video computer system.
1, 2, 3, go!
Mega Mania! Mega Mania! Mega Mania! It's gonna drive you insane.
You've got to live and survive, and you've got to run to stay alive.
Is a video nightmare because it's impossible to stop.
Designed by Steve Cartwright.
Mega Mania!
For Activision.
Take off with the most exhilarating new car of the year, the Datsun Turbo ZX. Now available with 5 speeds in 2 or 4-seater. the 5-speed Turbo ZX. This year, shift into something awesome.
For the fans here, congratulations, Daryl, on another super run.
Oh, man, it was just great out there today. You know, we had Bobby going there in the early part, but the car just really run well and really had it going our way. Before I forget it, I got to say happy birthday to Joe Block and tell everybody this Valvoline, Mountain Dew, Goodyear Buick just did one fantastic job.
Well, it certainly did. It looked like it was running on rails out there.
Well, in the early going, the track started to tear up, and I said, oh, my gosh, I thought I had a tire going bad. Took me a few laps to realize that it was the racetrack, not the car, and Bobby got by me. And then we adjusted the car, and everything worked fine after that. I wish Bobby had stayed in. I think we really put on a good show for people.
Daryl, that was my next question. A lot of fans would think, well, boy, you'd be tickled to death to see your strongest competitor in the race, as well as strongest competitor for the Winston Cup Championship, go out. But that's really not the way you feel.
Not really, Ned. Bobby Allison and all those boys have worked just as hard as we have. They've had some breaks when we haven't, and today we got one and they didn't. We're going to have a great finish to this point thing, and we know that. We know we're going to be in it, and we just thank the good Lord that this car is running as good as it is, our crew's functioning as well as it is at this time of year, because that's what it's all about. I just turn it over to the Lord and let him take control.
Sort of reminds you of the stretch run of 1981.
Well, it don't only sort of remind me of it, Ned. I'll tell you right now, it's exactly the same deal as last year. And we just come into these tracks that are good for us, good for the car, good for me, and we go out and do a good job, the crew does. And they know we're going to get the job done. They got so much darn confidence, I can't let them down. So, like I said, it's just going good for us, and Mountain Dew people. And I want to compliment Goodyear, especially today, Ned, because the track tore up. And them people could build a tire and run on snow, ice, that rain, whatever. They're the greatest, and I wanted to compliment them.
Well, these fellows knows what it takes to win one of these Winston Cup races. And you know about confidence, there's a pretty lady here right behind him that has a lot of confidence in him. And, of course, he gets that kiss from Stevie, his wife, here in Victor Lane, and I know you're happy of
him. I really am. I'd like to give God the glory for this win. We really have so much to be thankful for, and I'd like to tell my mother and dad hello and wish they were here with us.
Well, they're seeing you right now, live here on ESPN.
Yeah, you know, I guess people thinking, why are we speaking so much of God? But we've prayed a lot about this thing, and we think it's going to really pay off.
Well, I tell you, that is super.
Well, Larry, let's elaborate a little bit on a point that was made there just a few minutes ago. This is very reminiscent of last year at this time when Daryl was in the battle for the lead and suddenly came on to win it.
Yeah, it really is. That streak drive of the 1981 season, the last 14 races, never lower than sixth. And he had something like 7 wins in those last 14 shows.
Well, that is the view of Victory Lane at North Wilkesboro that is occupied right now by Daryl Waltrip. We'll review the top 10 and also be back to have some closing comments about this race that we have just seen in just a moment.
I do a lot of weekend driving in pretty heavy traffic, and everything's riding on my Goodyear. These racing tires give me the kind of handling I need. And during the week,
I count on Goodyear Street Radio.
An official speed of the race, 98.071 miles an hour. And the NASCAR officials have calculated for us, and as you indicated, Larry, it is a 15-point difference between Allison and Waltrip as we go to the next race. A summary of this race showed we had only 2 leaders, 4 lead changes, and a total of 4 caution periods. The average speed, 98.071. The time was 2 hours, 32 minutes, and 15 seconds, and the winning margin was 10 seconds.
Something else that was nice about today's race, there are a lot of folks who've been out there slugging away all year long, have had some tough breaks, and they had good days today. Some of those people, Jeff Bodine, who has qualified very quickly on a number of occasions this year. Jeff had a real shot at maybe even a runner-up, certainly a third position, until he over-anticipated a green flag on a restart. He had to pull into the pit area. It cost him a couple of positions, which he never made up. Jeff ended up coming home in fifth position. Joe Ruttman, who has dropped out of so many races today, or rather this year, was as high as third. The car slowed down on him a little bit near the end of the race, but he was on the track at the end of the race, and that has got to be a victory of some sorts for Bob Rahilly and Butch Mock, and congratulations to that crew. They recently heard that Joe is planning on leaving them at the end of the season, but it was a great day for the Ray Mock Racing team and Joe Ruttman.
And as far as the petties are concerned, Richard finished fourth here this afternoon, and Kyle was in 10th position, so both of the petties in the top 10. Well, we will be back in just a moment as we wrap up the activity here at North Wilkesboro, North Carolina, the Holly Farm Farms 401 today by Darrell Waltrip. Darrell Waltrip, and although Bobby Allison dropped out of competition with a blown engine, Bobby Allison still has a 15-point lead in the battle for the Winston Cup. Second place finisher today, and a great job, Harry Gant, and here is Ned Jarrett with him.
Well, Harry, congratulations on a good run. Not quite good enough, though.
No, I was pleased to get second here today. Darrell has always run this race real good, and his car handled real good all day, and we knew he was going to be real hard to beat, but I think we accomplished something here today. You know, we had the second best car out there, and the last pit stop we got some bad front tires, and you couldn't get the car to turn, but if they had me everything, I think we'd have been closer at them, but still, that's not to get lapped here to Darrell's accomplishment.
Harry, when you say you got a bad set of tires, that doesn't mean that there was anything wrong with the tires. They were just off on the size.
Well, it was off on the size, or it might have been some compounds vary a little bit. It's more likely it would have been the size because it were new, but you can't predict what they're going to do once they get hot unless you've run them a few laps. So we went with brand new ones instead of a scuff tire the last time, and evidently the right front must have grown real quick, and then the car would never turn. It'd get hot and give up once it got big. So other than that, I think we could have stayed up real good if we'd have kept the tires like we had coming on early.
You look pretty refreshed and relaxed after driving 400 hard laps out there.
Well, 400 is not really that much here, you know, on this racetrack, and like it is on a bigger racetrack, but it's not that much, really.
Bob, that's not exactly the way I remember back when I drove. Of course, it was dirt back then and a little bit harder to drive.
All right, Ned. Harry, of course, was the winner of the Winston Cup race earlier this year in Martinsville, Virginia, and the most recent Martinsville race was rained out. I'm sure Harry will be looking for his second win when they return to Martinsville.
Bob, I want to make mention of one other guy who had a pretty good day, Lake Speed. He was fast in qualifying yesterday, and he turned in an excellent performance here this afternoon in the 400-lap race. Lake was on the racetrack with the Petties, with Dale Earnhardt, with Ron Bouchard, and Jody Ridley most of the day. He was always in heavy traffic, or so it seemed, every time he looked up. And Lake comes home in seventh position. Now, interestingly enough, that is not his finest finish of the year. He finished sixth at Darlington. Remember his performance on the big track. Three races ago, he's also had a couple of other top 10 finishes. You might have guessed it. Daytona was a ninth place finish in the July 4th race there. But Lake Speed, congratulations, old buddy. You had another good day here, and they've not come all that often for him. He's one of those people struggling to make a name for himself.
And what about Terry Labonte, who finished in third place? Terry, of course, with a very successful first half of the season, was the winner of the halfway point in the Winston Cup standings. And Terry had not had a top five finish since the race at Bristol, but finishes third here today. And he had a rough going in the early stages of this race. He came in for several pit stops, and the hood was up on the car several times, but he managed to come home in third position.
Yeah, we never really got a confirmation on it, but I'm guessing that the hood went up for some chassis adjustments. You can change the chassis by going in under the hood, because the car was running in the top two or three positions there the first 10 laps of the race, and then suddenly started to back up. Terry is another one of those teams that is involved in the year innuendo situation, if you will. There might be some changes on that team for next year. But Labonte running a very strong second half of the race here this afternoon, and he racks up yet another top five finish, top four finish, and he's had quite a string of those this year.
All right, let's review the top 20 for you. We like to give you as many positions as we possibly can as far as finishes are concerned. The winner of the race, of course, was Darrell Waltrip. Harry Gant finishes second, and Terry Labonte was third. Richard Petty finished in fourth position, and Jeff Bodine was fifth. Sixth place, Joe Ruttman. The seventh place finisher was Ron Bouchard. Eighth was Lake Speed. Ninth was Jody Ridley. And tenth was Kyle Petty. Finishing 11th was Dave Marcus. 12th was Mark Martin. 13th, Morgan Shepherd. 14th, Jimmy Means. And 15th, D.K. Ulrich.
16th finisher was Jeff McDuffie, 17th James Hilton, Cecil Gordon finished 18th, Tommy Gale 19th, and Dale Earnhardt finished in 20th position. Today's race was brought to you by Saunders Leasing System. Rent or lease the big rig from Saunders. And by Natural Light, the beer with the taste for food. Well, ESPN will have another live telecast for you from Rockingham, North Carolina, the Warner Hodgson American 500, live on Sunday, October 24th. We hope you'll be with us.